talk about your single mothers just for a second. When single mothers say, I don't know if the brother likes me. The brother say, I like the sister, but she got kids. There's a few questions you need to ask to determine, brothers, if you want to marry a sister who has children. Write this down. All praise to the Most High. I'm glad everyone arrived safely. Sisters, how are y'all doing this Sabbath day? Good. Brothers, how are you brothers doing?
Good.
I see we have some guests from out of town. I'm so glad to see you brothers and sisters. All praises. Today we're going to touch on a few things. We're going to touch on a favorite topic. A topic that will never grow old. Oh. Marriage. We're going to touch on that. I just got to talk about it. And I'm going to explain to you later on why I'm talking about it. It's not the reason why some of you may be thinking. Some of the brothers know why I'm talking about it. I don't have a title. Give me a title. No. You know, in the news, they got this thing about the super delegates. And a lot of times you hear black people and Latino people really think that their voting counts. Well, it says New York superdelegates largely back Clinton over Sanders. I'm not going to watch the video, but notice the second title says superdelegates to pick Hillary, even if Bernie Sanders wins New York. See,
that told it all right there. That spelled it all over. That took the whole, you know what that did? That took the voting booth out of New York.
I tell you, because you get X amount of delegates that back up the candidate, mm-hmm. back up a candidate. If the voters, let's say three of us vote for Josiah, there'll be a super delegate right. that's going to pick him based on our voting. But they're telling you super delegates to pick Hillary, even if Bernie Sanders wins New York. They are the devil.
Yeah.
This whole voting process is garbage. Give me the next clip.
But wait a minute, Bishop. For them to even write that suggests the level of intelligence of the American people.
Right. Watch this. Go over to the far left. Yeah, right there. That's it. Yeah. Look at this one. Do y'all see the title here? I want y'all to look at this title. This is on CNBC. We choose the nominee, not the voters, senior GOP official. Now, I don't want no video. All I want is, because I don't like looking at that fool. I just want the title.
Come back to the title. See, you didn't get it.
He's lost in the sauce.
He's lost in that hot sauce.
Of the NASDAQ.
Hold it. If it's saying we choose the nominee, not the voters, who's the we?
You got those electoral guys.
That's letting you know that the we and the voters are not the same people. What that's telling you.
Letting you know voters have no power, no say in nothing. This whole voting process is a waste of time. Go ahead, Lava. What were you going to say?
You have noticed that for them to have the confidence to put it in the people's eyes like that, to show on you that the people is spiritually, mentally, they're dead. He's telling you the truth, but our people who read that don't have no understanding behind it.
Exactly.
Go right back to sleep.
Yeah, I'm going to go vote. As soon as I'm voting, you idiot. Give me Psalms 94, is it 20, I think? Yeah, Psalms 94 and 20. Give me that. I want to start there. Go ahead.
How many of y'all voted before? Be honest. Okay, see all them hands there.
You mean now, in the past?
Yeah, I'm talking about what I mean, in the past. Now, you've been inside the voting booth, correct? And y'all pulled the lever. When you pull that lever, don't you hear something that you get this sound of vroom. You hear this powerful thrust, like you really controlled something. They put that sound effect in there to make you think you did something. Something's being dramatic, but y'all know what I mean. Go ahead.
Psalms 94:20, please.
Psalms 94:20. Shall the throne of iniquity have fellowship with thee, which frameth mischief by a law?
America is the throne of iniquity. Another word for throne is kingdom. The kingdom of iniquity have fellowship with thee. And our people, in all their Christian minds, attempt to have fellowship with Babylon the Great. The Most High is telling us we cannot have fellowship with them. Just like they can't have fellowship with the Most High, we can't have fellowship with Babylon because it's two different things.
Looking at it from years from now, or 5 years from now, or 10 or 15 years from now. You know why I say that? Because when you're looking at the world, they're not looking at these things as that's it. Israel, like that's it. There is no more. You understand? Meaning that there is no more, you know, like the world believe in religion. But a nation being built right in front of the great kingdom on earth, which is America, your guys don't see it. You're all part of a great things on earth that your guys don't understand yet. That's why we're still dealing with Negroes mentality. We're still dealing with the sin that you're into. We're still dealing with the folly you're into because you have not tell yourself that I am a part of a great things on earth. God has chosen you to bring this truth out to your people. Out of 1,000. Think about it. You on, Bishop? Yeah. Out of 1,000. Think about it. So yours chose for a reason. You have to tell yourself that. We can win millions of classes, but you have to tell yourself I'm special. God has chosen me to bring this truth out to his people, which is the nation of Israel. 12 tribes. It's an easy... It seemed like a hard fight if you're still dealing with the old man. It's an easy fight when you're dealing within the spirit. You understand the soul of yours. You understand? Understand that you are a very powerful person on earth. That you're very dangerous to this earth. You understand? You have to believe that. You are very dangerous to this earth. Why? You're bringing the truth out. In a time where shadow of death, when a time of wicked things, in a time of corruptions, you understand? You chose to do what's right according to the Lord, laws, statutes, and commandments. You very dangerous man. You understand? You a marked man. When you pick up this Bible, you a marked man. Then when you pick up this Bible, you become a judge automatically because the Bible dealing with what? With laws. So automatically you understand this thing, you become a judge. That's why judge dealing with laws. You understand? So be very mindful, man. Control your spirit. How do you do that, Deacon Laba? You mean like Bishop Kanai like to said, you have to tell yourself that I cannot think for myself. These men, I have to listen the word they're bringing out. That's what I need for my soul. We don't need you to think for yourself. You know why? Because you're not capable of thinking for yourself. When you was thinking for yourself, looking at before you came here, when you was thinking for yourself, what good decision you ever made? You have to tell yourself that. I never made no good decision. I know I never made no good decision when I was in the world. That was all decision to hang myself, either going in jail or either to get killed. That's the only decision I made when I was in the world. You have to tell yourself the same. You were the most wicked brothers in the earth before God has chosen you. Now he's chosen you to bring this truth out to your people, man. Know how to control your spirit. That's why we here. Why we in this tabernacle? You understand? Use us. You understand? Because we're going to be a perfect example for you in the spirit of Christ.
What Deacon Laba said was heavy. I gleaned something that he said. He said that when we were in our mind state, talking about when he said that we are a danger to ourselves, something to the effect of that. Our thinking is no good in the sense before we came into repentance. So if our thinking was all messed up, our thinking is garbage and the rest of it, think about the love that the Lord had to cause within the midst of all that sickness in our heads. He calls you to come through these doors and to repent and get your mind straight with the word of the Lord. Think about what I'm saying. Because it's not like our, it's not like we just woke up on our own. We're in the midst of our craziness, in the midst of our sin, in the midst of our evil, wickedness, and all the rest of it, the Lord says, you know what? I'm going to put a splinter in that person's mind to make them wake up. Okay, so when you come into this, you have to realize that the rest of you is still sick. You follow me? I'm talking about all of us. Y'all all right? So that's what this medicine is about. This medicine is about the continual working and the anointment on our spirit to get us 100% under the vibration of the Lord. So it takes work. Y'all understand what I'm saying? All right. Go ahead, Bishop.
Get Matthew 24. Deacon Lauber said we are one of a thousand. And that's correct according to the book of... Get that real quick in Job 23, something like that. About one of a thousand. Show how important you are. And it's very important we go over these scriptures because half of us, probably three quarters, maybe damn near all of us, got a low self-esteem. So these things are in the Bible to encourage us. Thank you. Go ahead.
The book of Job, chapter 33, verse 23. If there be a messenger with him, an interpreter, one among a thousand, to show unto man his uprightness.
Read again.
If there be a messenger with him, an interpreter, one among a thousand.
Right. You brothers are the interpreters. You are the one among a thousand. That's how important and how valuable we are in the sight of the Most High. Okay. Now get me Matthew 24 and 14. Okay, because like Deacon Yarosab, you said, we didn't wake ourselves up. It's the Spirit of God that woke us up. Every last one of us, man and woman, the Spirit of the Anointed Father came upon us and awakened us to this truth. Now, this is what the scripture said. This is what Christ said about this thing. Go ahead.
And this gospel of the kingdom shall be preached in all the world for witness unto all nations, and then shall the end come.
So everybody's going to hear this word. Everybody's going to hear this word before the end comes. Now, there's a video that Shiloh had sent us. He had posted it. Give me that. The rap battle. I like that. Started 37 minutes. Now, y'all online, there's some vulgarity. So before you don't play nothing, give them a chance to take their chillins out the room. It's a little vulgar. It's not a lot. But I don't want no emails. Well, why'd you put that video? My children heard them. Like they ain't never heard them words right, before.
We're giving you the disclaimer now.
You know, I tell you, that's what we're going to see today. I got the title today. It's going to be Single Parents Need Love Too. That's the title of today's class.
Single Parents Need Love Too.
That's the name of the class. Right. And because it's these single parents that go, why? My child, I sat up to watch and I hear curse. Listen, you know daggone well. Your child could probably school us on vulgarity. Yep. Like they never heard these words before. Like when they go to school, there's some little snot-nosed kid just cursing left and right, showing you. There's always one little kid that shows them how to spell the curse words, how to pronounce it. Y'all it's
think,
not one.
Hey, listen, y'all think the bishop is going overboard. I'm telling you firsthand, I know about that thing. All right,
see,
go ahead.
Can I say that? I'll say it later. You started 37 minutes.
His diet wrong.
Wait, stop. Now, they have these stupid, I don't watch these rap battles. I think it's stupid as hell. Some of y'all like this stuff. But anyway, I saw it, this part. You got a Palestinian guy. He's Palestinian, the one with the black hat and the chain, the one facing us. He's from Palestine. And the one next to him is so-called Jewish. The one he's battling. So they're battling each other. Who's the best rapper? Listen to what the Palestinian guy says in his rap. In the point of me showing this is what we read about everyone's going to hear this truth.
And I got more examples. And I got more examples. No matter how many menorah lamps you have, you'll never hold a candle to the levels of pressure I was born to handle. You know why? Because you don't have no souls or backbones. Bro, you don't even know your past, bro. Real Jews were Hebrews, black men who used to grow their afros. You guys are just a bunch of fucking random phony Polish assholes who forged your passports and don't have a land of your own, so you come over and they jack yours. But what is it all for? Is it drilling offshore? Is it the land? Or do you want more? See, Arabs, we're peaceful, bro. You could come into my house. I invite you in. Take the keys to my car, the garage door. I just want you to feel comfortable at home since you're used to occupying households that are not yours.
Let's go.
brother's gonna forget what he just said. So let me see. Out of all of that, some butter. Who caught it? Who had their biscuits ready when that butter went out there? I see all them hands, right? I know some skipped over some of the biscuits, but who caught it? All right, I see Ruben. I'm going to give you a try. Ruben, my man Ruben. That's right, you.
He said that the Jews were black and they were growing froze back in the days.
Your butter caught it. All right. Your biscuit caught it. That biscuit caught it. The butter running all down the jaws and all that. So that's all right. So did y'all hear that? Go ahead, Bishop. I know you want to expound on that thing.
No. Get Psalms 19. I just want to show you that this, the point of that video, as I said, was just to show that everyone is listening to the word coming out. When the so-called, when they established YouTube, which was meant to have Big Brother watch everybody, little did they know, the Most High is a master strategist. He let them, in the pride of their mind, think that they're observing us and everybody else, but God's getting his word taught throughout the world,
right?
Places that we would never be able to go,
exactly.
Physically. He says, it's going to get there. Don't worry. Read that.
Wait a minute.
Hold on.
Now, the man, you had the so-called Jew that was on the other side. He didn't get to speak yet, right? Y'all with me? Then you had the man from Palestine, the Palestinian. What do they say about the Palestinians? Not about being wild. In terms of the land of Israel. What do they say about the Palestinians? Y'all know about their waters over there, right? The Gaza Strip and all that. What is the point that they're making of? What is the point that they say about Palestinians? Who knows? What do they say about them? Few hands. All right, Jonah, come on.
They say it's not their land.
Okay, you have some people say that the Palestinians are the rightful owners of their land. That's what they try to say. And then they say that the so-called Jews took it from them. That's the reason why they're fighting. But then here you have the actual Palestinians saying that the real Jews are black. So he's knocked himself out the box. Y'all didn't get that, did y'all? Did they get it, Bishop?
I think so. Remember right. Gamal Abdul Nasser?
Exactly.
Tell them about Gamal Abdul Nasser.
Gamal Abdul Nasser. I hope I'm saying his name right. I got to be looking at it. Nasser, blah, blah, blah. Y'all know about him. The ambassador that was over there during that time. He made a statement about, he said, how could the Jews leave Israel black and come back white? Mm-hmm. Yep. Okay.
And after that, they had the six-day war.
Right. They had that war over there after that. Exactly. And that's what that whole mess was about, him throwing rocks over there in the Gaza Strip and all
right.
that
thing. He was the president of Egypt.
Mm-hmm.
Right. Gamal Abdul Nasser. Right, exactly. Now, what did I say, go?
Psalms 19, verse 4.
2-4. I want
2-4. Day unto day uttereth speech.
Day unto day uttereth speech. Now, spiritually, when we're reading this, we understand now that the Most High is having his word taught day by day by day. That's the power of the internet. Read again.
Day unto day uttereth speech.
Right, God's speech. Go ahead.
And night unto night showeth knowledge.
Night unto night showeth knowledge. That's why them videos, they don't just sit there. People are watching them on all around the world. That's why they call it the World Wide Web. Mm-hmm. Go ahead.
There is no speech nor language where their voice is not heard.
And these things are translated in other countries. What verse was that?
That was verse 3.
Go ahead.
Their line is gone out through all the earth.
You know, I like that part right there. So the Most High is going to make sure his proper teaching is gone throughout the earth. That's what he's going to make sure goes down.
Bishop, can I say something? Yeah. Read verse 3 again.
There is no speech nor language where their voice is not heard.
They're telling you the gospel is going out in all language.
Not just Hebrew?
Not just Hebrew. Creole, French, Spanish, Arab. That's what he's telling you. That the gospel will go out to all language that God created. The gospel will go in because Israel is in every island and every place and every country. That's what he's letting you know.
Exactly. Now, we want to talk about single parents need love too. I'm going to tell you why we're talking about it. I might not know why I'm talking about it. But there's been a lot of emails and a lot of questions during Passover time where single parents say, listen, I have children or a child and or children, and the brothers might not want to talk to me, or they say the sister may not want to talk to me. So I pondered on that thing. Very interesting. So I ponder on this. So let's open up with Hebrews 13 and 4. I'm going to help y'all with some secrets today. So y'all just take notes. I got to stretch. Sorry. This class, I'm telling you. Some of y'all get mad and walk out, but that's all right. You'll be okay.
The book of Hebrews, chapter 13 and verse 4. Marriage is honorable in all, and the bed undefiled. But whoremongers and adulterers God will judge.
So marriage is honorable. This is why in this camp we teach marriage. We don't teach wham, bam, thank you, ma'am. And we bring forth swift judgment on anyone whoremongering, fornicating. You will be put out. And be grateful to God if you are left alive to return. Because if not, he might kill you out there or make your mind go. Then you'd be bugged out. Okay, read that again.
Marriage is honorable in all, and the bed undefiled. But whoremongers and adulterers God will judge.
Now, get me Matthew 19 and 5. Matthew 19 and 5. Now, after Passover, people got mad at Lava. They said he was abusing the people, having them go up. They said he's just too wild. So they asked me if I could deal with it from now on and not let him do it. So you're Lava, you're fired.
Matthew chapter 19, verse 5. And said, for this cause shall a man leave father and mother.
Now, this is one of the first things. Before the young men went up, this is after Passover. We said, if you live with your mama, don't go up there talking about you ready for a wife. Right. You ain't ready. Read that again.
And said, for this cause shall a man leave father and mother.
Key word, leave father and mother, not stay with father and mother. Can you tell a young black and Latin man that says, leave mommy and daddy? Leave. They don't understand that for some reason.
No, they don't understand that word leave encompasses a whole lot of responsibility.
There you go. Because when you leave, that means you're able to take care of yourself and someone else. That's what it implies.
It ain't just mean leaving. You got the knapsack on a stick.
Yeah. You
know, with the polka dots in it.
Exactly. And you on a corner just standing there.
No.
Read that again, Captain.
And said, for this cause shall a man leave father and mother and shall cleave to his wife.
See that? And shall cleave to his wife.
Not girlfriend.
Right. Not girlfriend. Cleave to his wife. There's a difference between a girlfriend and a wife. A girlfriend, if you didn't know, is a hoe. Let me say it again. A girlfriend is a hoe. She's a round-the-way girl. Because when she ain't your girlfriend no more, she gonna be somebody else's girlfriend. Boyfriend is a whoremonger. Because when he leave her, he's going to another her. That's worldly terms for whoremongering. Girlfriend, boyfriend. We all had them back before we repented. We know what we did. The vileness that we did. You know, young kids, smell my fingers. So, see, some people laugh because they know what we did when we was little. That's what we did. I'm sorry. I'm going to get an email tonight. How nasty. I'm sorry.
You get an email for it. They all did it. What the hell is this? Get an email.
Now, get Psalms 45 and 10. Now, women be happy. Yeah, because he's a mama boy. He's always with his mama. He can't leave his mama alone. I go to the movie, the mama's on my shoulder. I go to the bathroom, she's got her head in the bathroom. She's always there. So now, watch this, with what the Bible says about to the women.
Psalms 45 and verse 10. Hearken, O daughter, and consider, and incline thine ear. Forget also thine own people and thy father's house.
See that? Forget also your own people and your father's house. Keyword, forget them. You know why that's so important? Because women, read it again.
Hearken, O daughter, and consider, and incline thine ear. Forget also thine own people and thy father's house.
Right. So likewise for the women, forget your own people and forget your father's house. Because women like to, you get married, she want to move here, and her parents live right there. But we don't want to live near your parents. Because you know what that means, brothers, when you live near her parents? Her parents is in your place. Her parents is in your business. Her parents is all it. I wouldn't let him talk to me like that. This is what happens. And the parents end up causing divorce and problems in the home. I've seen it time in, time out. Y'all know what I'm talking about? Some of you brothers know. Because she want to be near. In case I get in an argument with him, I go to my mama's house. Meaning, I don't want to stay here with you and deal with you as a wife. I'm going to run and go to my mommy and daddy house. That's what women do. They want to live right there, near, right in the vicinity. Ask my wife. We went far away. I ain't seen my parents in a long time. They said, why are you so far? I had a good reason why I'm far. So, get me Sirach chapter 6 and 7. I'm about to prove a friend. So, some people announced their betrothal, which I was very glad of hearing. But, because I listened to, I'm with betrothed, and I said, praise to the Most High. But I knew there's something behind it. Read that verse.
The book of Sirach, chapter 6 and verse 7. If thou wouldest get a friend, prove him first.
This is the step most of you make the mistake and don't apply. You meet the woman, she got a big butt and a smile, and you like that. You don't prove her. Rubbing on her is not proving her, brothers. That's not proving her, I'm telling you. Sisters, speaking sweet nothings in his ears, not proving him. Now, you brother, let me tell you something. Everybody talk about the white man as the devil, and they hate child support. Everyone hates child support. But you get hooked up with a demon that you didn't prove. You talk about she is the one. I have a million stories for you brothers. There have been sisters that come in Israel and will shalom you to death. Shalom. Shalom. Praise Jesus. Get with you. The second you get with her, lay with her, she wind up pregnant. Then she's out. She's gone. I didn't want to believe this truth. She got you. Now you owe child support because she hit you with the courts and you mad calling the white man the devil. But if you had just done this, one more again.
If thou wouldest get a friend, prove him first.
You wouldn't have been hooked and caught with the ratchet sister who played your stupid self. She sat there and just waited for the precious soul. Because there are some women, not all, and not these lovely sisters here. Not them. There are some women. You know the sister you see on the news that's always on welfare? Y'all know them ratchet hoes. There are women who will sit back and say, I'm not working. I don't want to work. I don't want no. I need somebody to take care of me, my baby. You know what I'm going to do? I'm going to go to that Israelite school. I'm going to sit there and wait. There's some, I look good too. I'm going to get one of them. Watch. That has happened. I would call names, but I know they're online. I ain't going to call any who it has happened to.
Now, wait a minute. I got to back you up, Bishop. And the reason why you know that's what the kind of talk that they do, because one of the things that they discuss among themselves is that school there, they make these men take care of those sisters. Huh? Exactly. So they said, if you get a man from that group, because they're going to make sure that these brothers take care of them. And so they come in here and look for you. And they sit back and they study you. There he is right there. I'm going to take my time, man. Just, you know, a couple of scriptures. Hey, brother, the bishop was going over a class and I came across this scripture here. Can you break this down for me? I said, well, yes. I said, but right now I got to go. Won't you come by later on and show it to me? Show it to me. Go ahead, Bishop.
Now, some of the sisters might be annoyed that they blowing my spot up. Why they blowing my spot up like that? We got to blow your spot up. During Passover, now we had a wonderful time during Passover, but then I get an annoying phone call. You know what I'm talking about. Around this time, brother goes, I have to be a responsible leader. So a sister calls him. Now, the brother got his wife and kid laying in the bed. They sleep. Ring, ring, ring. This is out there. It's 3 o'clock in the morning. No, I think y'all are still there. Can you come counsel me? Here comes the sister. Can you come counsel me? And a brother in his simple behind. I'm responsible. I have to go counsel this sister. Hello, it's 3 o'clock in the morning. Hello. He goes, let's go to a restaurant. They go to the restaurant, sit down. She's, are you hungry? He says, no, I'm not hungry. She orders a plate of food. Then she wants to feed him. You see this?
You sure we weren't gone? I think me and I thought we were gone. I know I was gone. Me and ASAP was out.
You see? Things like this irk me. I'm like, what am I hearing? So, see, some of the things is too unbelievable. Be like, no, that didn't happen. Yes, yes, yes. See, brother, some of you brothers think y'all got game. Women got game, too. They know there is a punk in you. I can get that.
That's why they sit back and watch.
Brothers be thinking, I go to the gym. I look good. My beard is manicured. I got game. The women's going, no, you don't. I got game.
She's saying, we going to see.
We going to see. And then they be brothers be thinking, she hit me for child support. That B hit me for child support, bruh.
Now she's a B.
Yeah, now she's a B. Get 1 John 4:1. Watch what the New Testament says about the same thing.
She became a bee at 3 in the morning.
Yeah.
Huh?
So yeah, simple. 1 John 4:1, please.
1 John 4:1. Beloved, believe not every spirit.
So you brothers, you sisters, don't believe every spirit that smiles in your face. Go ahead.
But try the spirits.
Try the spirits. Go ahead.
Whether they are of God, because many false prophets are gone out into the world.
Right, because you brothers go out there talking about, sister, I got the scripture. I got the breakdown that you need. And she's going, preach on, brother. Preach on. You go, man, God has anointed you. And a brother.
How about this one? I don't want him to anoint me. I want him to anoint me.
Yeah, exactly. We all kind of foolishness. Give me Sirach 37, please. So again, so the point of Sirach 6 and 7, 1 John 4:1. Let me see. What is the point of those two verses, brothers? Raise your hand if you got the answer. You. Yes. Yeah, you with the hand up. Your hands are up in the spirit. You. Yeah, you. Yes. I see your hand went like that. Real high. The question is, what is the relation between Sirach 6 and 7, 1 John 4:1, that we need to apply?
Is that we have to get to know the individual before we get to know the individual.
Yes. Yes. Get to know them. And that don't happen in a month or two, brothers, sisters. Here we go. We're in, where were we at? Some of you, I ain't going to point you out. Where was we? Atlanta. The sister goes, oh, I'm talking to brother so-and-so. I said, you talking to brother so-and-so? Who is brother so-and-so? She go, right there. Really? Did y'all meet before? She says, on Facebook. Them Facebook hookup brothers. Sister, let me talk to the sisters. Stop. Women, stop. Brother going to travel from New York to Atlanta and use the guys, the smoke screen of, it's a new school opening, so I just want to participate in the festivities. No. You're there for some punani. That's why you are there. You never met your sister except on Facebook, but you're flying out. What is going on with some of these brothers? She look good, and she's so simple. Oh, he look good. Sister, do you know him? No, but on Facebook, we talk a lot. That's not proving. Can you read it? Go back. I'm sorry. Go back.
You know what the problem is, Bishop? All these classes, like Digalaba said earlier, all these classes go out. All of these scriptures go out. All of this deep breakdown. And we go through the scriptures clearly, plain in plain form, and nobody's listening. So then they get out there and make the same stupid mistakes, and then we read it. How many times have we read these scriptures?
Exactly. Oh, I got another story. I ain't going to call a DJ man that used to be with us, the DJ brother. Flies out Now, we ain't see the brother in a long while. All of a sudden, he's in Florida and convinced a sister in Florida that he's about, listen to the game, he's about to receive royalty money of thousands upon thousands of dollars. And the woman saw cha-ching, cha-ching in both eyes. And all of a sudden, he became daddy. He became, give me a good-looking brother out in the media. He became, like, I don't know how they feel about Idris Elba, but, or Denzel. No, he's too old. Somebody younger. Terrence Howard. He became Terrence Howard. With light-skinned brother with the hazel eye. Oh, he look like Terrence Howard. That nigga don't look like a Terrence Howard. And she lays in the bed with the brother. Now, some women get pregnant like that. Sure enough, ba-ding, then she gives us the call. We get the call. Have you seen brother so-and-so?
No, we didn't get the call before that happened.
Exactly. We didn't get the call before she laid down. We get the call after. Have you seen brother so-and-so? No, we haven't seen brother so-and-so. Why? What's going on? Well, he had, we pregnant. Y'all got together? Yes, we got together. We're madly in love. You're madly in love? Well, where is he? I don't know. You dumb. Dumb, dumb. Can you read that one more again?
Sirach 6 verse 7. If thou wouldest get a friend, prove him first, and be not hasty to credit him.
Y'all see that? So, sisters, don't think because the brother coming with fringes and a, how you say it, Lorda? Lava, a bottom of blue? A bottom of blue. The boot in my blue.
Yeah, Bishop. But, you know, like, with all that you've been said, right, you would think brothers and sisters kind of feel the word of God. Because we bring many scriptures. I know our tongue have a nice clip on marriage. But then you will have sister call you, really ask you about marriage. I have a sister call me. He said, oh, I was watching Deacon Athan video about marriage. And I tell her, and she said, yeah, I was just watching, but it's kind of rough. I said, yeah, whatever the brother bring out is in the spirit. That's what's good for you, sister. But for some reason, they call us like we're supposed to change the scripture for them. That's the point. You understand? You're not going to catch me changing no scripture for you. You better get in the spirit because we bring many class. As a matter of fact, Bishop, that was Passover. The laws go out like if you're interested in a sister, you call whoever the camp is, the leader over there. It's a brother. He come. He told me, he said, Deacon Laba, I feel like I was rejected. I'm listening to that brother. He said, yeah, the sister told me. I just introduced myself to the sister. Sister told me, yeah, just checking with my captain. But I said, is that a form of rejection? I said, no, she's following the protocol. I said, why would we want to be rejected? If as soon you talk to her, she tell you that I'm not interested. That's reject. I said, she just followed what we saying she was supposed to be following. He's saying to me, that's not enough. He said, at least can she tell me if she interested in me before I call the captain?
Didn't he say, what scripture is that? What scripture is that? That they got to check with the... Listen, obey them to have rule over you. Now sit your black behind down somewhere. And, you know, people try to be slick because we say check with the captain because we may see a sister or a brother. We may know but so much about them. We'll call the more senior brother that directly deals with the brother or the sisters and say, how's this brother? How's this sister? Get a report. That way we can tell you what we see about them, what is known throughout the congregation about that spirit who's been with us for at least a year. You heard the word I said?
Yeah.
At least a year. So we exactly. can tell you what we know for what that year time.
Exactly. This is what is termed as being the father to the fatherless. Because that's what we have to be a lot of times. We have to check out the different spirits in the different places. Because we don't want people just hooking up and they be bad for each other. Mm-hmm. Just like a father would watch over his children.
Exactly. Get Sirach 37 and 12.
Sirach 37 and verse 12. But be continually with a godly man, whom thou knowest to keep the commandments of the Lord.
Y'all see that? Whom thou knowest to keep the commandments. Not whom you assume to keep the commandments of the Lord. So brothers, so sisters, that means you have to prove someone. You can't prove them in a few days. You can't prove them on Facebook that they keep the commandments. On Facebook, you can only make an assumption. And let me tell you, brother, something. You got these scripture quoting sisters on Facebook. Watch them. Watch them, spirits. Because there'll be, we have had sisters up in here who have said, I don't want no man telling me what to do. Then go on Facebook and praise God and give scripture after scripture. And that is to deceive brothers to make you think she's a righteous sister. I'm going to give you another example. Con. I'm going to give you another example. Y'all know this story. Big sister. Big burly sister. I ain't got a problem with big burly sisters. Some big burly brothers like big burly sisters. That's fine. Burly. Big. Look like a linebacker. Her hand, if she smack you, you ain't getting back up. Now, some of you West Indian brothers, you like that type of thing. That's okay. What's the word?
Mumpy.
Well, that's okay if that's your thing. My thing is, if I can't carry you through the threshold, I can't. No. Mm-mm. My back's broke. No. But some of you brothers like that. That's okay. I'm not knocking y'all. Y'all look at a smaller woman, think she's anorexic. I'm like, are you crazy? Yeah. Benjamin Brothers, you just want to get on Benjamin, right? Anyway, the sister was one of them scripture quoting, I can't use the B word, but she's a scripture quoting sister. I'll just say it like that so I don't get emails of hate. The brother was so impressed by her on Facebook with all her scriptural analysis. She says she's godly. There were two sisters that were interested in him, so he says, you know what? He was on Facebook, so he said, I'm going to go with the one that knows scriptures. I said, are you sure that's the right decision? You want to talk to that one because she just quotes on Facebook? He goes, yeah, she knows. All right. So then when they decide they want to get betrothed, remember what we said to them? Check, get your medical records checked. Get tested for STDs. Blood test. So he goes to the doctor. He comes back with his paperwork. He goes, look, I got my sister. Here's my paperwork. She goes, well, praise God. Hallelujah. Well, you know I'm good. Hallelujah. So they get married. And the brother was a single father. He had a couple of kids. And he said he started noticing that his kids started getting bumps around their mouth. So he's looking. He's like, what is this? Where y'all getting this stuff from, these little bumps around the mouth? So just take him to the doctor when you can. Praise Jesus. Praise God. So one night, watch this. Here's game. She's in bed. He's in bed. He's asleep. He wakes up. Baby, what's the matter? What is wrong?
I got something to tell you.
What is it, baby? You can tell me.
I don't know if I should. Do you love me?
You know I love you, baby. You can tell me anything. She goes, okay. I have herpes. I didn't want to tell. He said, wait. Did you do the blood test? She says, no, I didn't show you because I had the herpes. Then the clincher. Remember the clincher? Because the brother recorded it. He couldn't believe it. They was arguing. She said, God wants you to have this disease.
They didn't.
You remember this, Lubba?
I remember it.
See, we got stories for y'all, and we try to warn y'all to protect you. But some of y'all don't listen to us. We just the three stooges of four blind mice. What's that? Three blind mice, the seven dwarfs. However y'all see us, I don't know how y'all see us. We put these classes out to protect you, but y'all know more than us.
God wanted you to have this. Think about that. What happens to your mind once you hear those words?
You want
to? Huh? Yeah, right. With all that, chest bumping them. She gonna chest bump me at the same time.
Yeah.
You know what I mean with chest bump? Move out the way, nigga. Boom.
I'll tell y'all, can you read that again, Cap?
Sirach 37, verse 12. But be continually with a godly man, whom thou knowest to keep the commandments of the Lord.
So, brothers, don't be deceived with scripture quoting. And vice versa, so some of these brothers can quote eloquently. You better observe them. If you are interested, talk to them. See, because sometimes your conversation will tell you. It'll give. Find me that scripture that says out of the abundance of the heart.
Right.
Who knows what that is? Where's that? Matthew 12:36. Thank you. Give me that.
But you know the reason why most people don't catch these things? I guess we should read the scripture first and let the bishop bring his point out.
Matthew 12 and...
Matthew 12:34. O generation of vipers, how can ye, being evil, speak good things? For out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaketh.
Whatever's the heart means your mind. The heart means, how do we know the heart means your mind? Let me see you, how many of you brothers are studying. You, with the glasses, right there. Yeah, you. No, behind you.
Matthew 7:21.
Mark 7:21. Right. Get Mark 7:21 to prove that the heart is the mind. Get that. Mark 7:21. Real quick, just to prove that the heart is the mind.
Mark 7:21. For from within, out of the heart of men, proceed evil thoughts.
So evil thoughts come out of your heart, proving that the heart in the Bible is referring to your mind. So Christ said here in Matthew 12, out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. Whatever's in your, whatever you fill your mind with is going to come out your mouth. That's why, what's that thing? Watch your thoughts,
for they become your words. You remember that, right? Your thoughts will eventually mark your destiny. Your thoughts will become your words. Your words will become action.
Yep.
Your actions will become habits. Your habits will form character, and your character will determine your destiny.
Exactly. Exactly. So you sisters talking to a brother, he's going to tell you what he's about. And after a while, just talk with a brother. He's going to tell you where he, like you talking about Tobit, about grow old together. He's not talking about growing old together with it. He don't want to talk about that. He want to talk about, what was his conversation?
Bump and grind.
Yeah, bump and grind. And it'll be very subtle at first, sister. It'll be very subtle. Because he'll try to keep his conversation biblical. But after he's looking at you, lusting after you, what's in his mind is going to start to come out of his mouth. And vice versa. Vice versa.
Right, exactly. And the thing is that you being on the other side of the dialogue, you have to know what to listen for. If you don't have a clue, then you get... Let me put it this way. If you're just as wicked as the person who's talking to you, you're going to go along with it.
Exactly.
But if you have your guard up, you're here in the conversation.
Exactly.
You say, this nigga ain't about trying to deal right with me.
Exactly. Exactly.
Or this hoe ain't trying to deal right with me. It'd be either way.
And watch these sisters that stay at your feet. Brother, you got some big feet. Wow. Look at them hands. Watch, that's a hoe. Here's another one. You go somewhere and you taking out your wallet to pay for something. Her eyes is in the wallet to see what's in there. Watch that. Gold digger. Look at the wallet's all thin. He ain't got no credit cards. Probably got bad credit. I ain't dealing with him. Watch, there's little telltale signs. Peep with these women. Oh, okay. Did you finish that, Captain?
Yes, sir.
Read again. Now go back to Sirach 37.
Sirach 37 and verse 12.
Brother Stu, then when sister have business, he would tell his sister, he don't have no good credit, say, the business is to be in my name, sister. Yeah. When the sister is doing good for herself, mm-hmm. brothers will use that. That's a spirit of abuse.
Yes.
When you heard that, ooh, cuckoo.
I'm glad you said that. Yeah. There are brothers who look for women who got money. That's what they do. Some brothers, because they don't want brothers. Some sisters, in case you didn't know, there's some slothful brothers in the Israelite community or the Kemetic Hebrew community. Mm-hmm. They look for the sister, got a little cheddar. And they come into the relationship, they want to put their name on all your documents. Yep. Watch, sisters, watch that Negro right there. There was a sister in Texas before we had a Texas camp out there. She would take, when the brothers was getting together, she would pay for the conference rooms and all of that so the brothers could get together because she had a nice job. She would look after the brothers, make sure they was taken care of. She was single sister. She hooked up with a Negro in Israel. And that sister that was so happy, Jovia wanted to help Israel, her spirit's gone. The spirit ain't like, it's like a total different sister now. She don't want to help nobody. She's miserable. She's quiet. She's scared to talk. What's wrong with you, sister? This ain't the same woman I met years ago. The man destroyed the spirit. You sisters get hooked up with a mentally abusive brother. Like Labo was saying, there's financial abuse that some brothers will run game on you.
Yeah, man, what about that? You forget that the brothers, sometimes sisters will be doing good for themselves. I mean, they have business partners. Then brothers will come and tell you, no, you have to divide. The sister your business partner with is no good.
Right.
Yeah, you have to get your own business going by yourself. Yep. Watch this spirit. This spirit ain't right.
And we got that in Israel. Just this week, brothers talking to the sister. Now, I'm going to get back to the scripture in a second. Don't let me talk too long. Brothers talking to the sister, like Deacon Laba said, the Negro comes out. The sister's been friends for years, got a business together. Here comes the Negro. You need to separate from her. Why? We're business partners, and we've been friends for years. What, is she saying something wrong? She's just not, it's not going to work out for you, sister. You need to just leave her. Do your own thing. This is the Negro trying to get in good with her so he can, that and that's why them things always fall apart. Then you look at God, because the sister, she don't want to talk to you no more. Lord Jesus, why can't I get a wife? Because you a nigger.
That's a covetous spirit.
Where we at, Captain?
Sirach 37, verse 12. But be continually with a godly man, whom thou knowest to keep the commandments of the Lord, mm-hmm. whose mind is according to thy mind.
So her mind got to be like your mind. His mind got to be like, meaning in these scriptures, they're about God's business. Come on.
And will sorrow with thee if thou shalt miscarry. Uh-huh. And let the counsel of thine own heart stand, for there is no man more faithful unto thee than it.
You know what that last part means? You know how sometimes you meet somebody and it's your mind, the spirit within you says, that bird ain't right. You get, there's something within you, the spirit says, he or she ain't right.
They call that a gut reaction out here in the street.
Right, exactly. That's exactly. Read that last, that precept you just read, that last one.
And let the counsel of thine own heart stand, for there is no man more faithful unto thee than it.
Sometimes you got to go with your gut feeling. Something ain't right. Something ain't right with this person. Lead up. Just observe and listen after that. Give me Sirach 18.
I'm going to dwell on that. That gut thing, because that's the spirit, really. The spirit telling you this Negro ain't right. So how is it that you went from, this person ain't right. The next same thing, you know, you gone with the wind. You gone. What happened? That Negro got to talking to you and got to telling you that the spirit that told you that I was a piece of garbage told you to the hell with that spirit and follow me. And then when it's all over, then that spirit come right back and say, I told you, dog, blah, 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 you know, that the dude wasn't no doggone good. Y'all all right? All right.
Read that. So, where did I say go? Sirach 18 and 14. This is the problem with a lot of us.
The book of Sirach, chapter 18 and verse 14. He hath mercy on them that receive discipline.
Discipline is applying God's laws. The only way for each of us to receive mercy is if we allow God's discipline in our lives, which is his commandments. Read it again.
He hath mercy on them that receive discipline and that
Diligently
seek after his judgments.
And that diligently seek after his judgments. So we got to ask, we come in this truth. That's why a lot of people say, I don't want to go to IUIC because there's discipline there. Too strict. I don't like that. I like that those carefree camps where I could do what I want to do, be with whoever I want to be with how many people I want to be with. It's no thing. But if that's for you, then go ahead. But up in here, we are receiving God's discipline, and it's a journey. It is something that we have to apply on a daily basis. From there, give me chapter 21, the same book, verse 11.
Chapter 21, verse 11. He that keepeth the law of the Lord getteth the understanding thereof.
So that's why we tell a lot of you, learn the laws of God first. Because when you start to learn the laws of God and apply them to your life, you will spot game instantly. Men and women, you'll spot it. You hear it. No, that's game. Why? Because the laws of God is in your mind. But if you got a BET in your mind, You got, what's that new hoe rapper? The not Lil' Kim, that's old school. Nicki Minaj in your mind. You're not going to spot nothing. You ain't going to be able to pick up on the subtleties of wickedness. Like, come over my house. I want you to expound the scriptures on to me tonight at midnight. Why do I need to go to your house at 3 in the morning? Why do I need to go meet you at 3 in the morning? Why don't you just come to the school and learn? Right. See, brothers, that's why scripture says your mind is able to tell you more than 1,000 watchmen. When a sister tells you to come meet her at 3 in the morning or midnight, now there's a story on that one, too. I got another story.
Wait a minute, bitch. Hold. It says your mind will tell you more than 1,000 watchmen? You all right? 1,000 watchmen will be the congregation. He will disregard all 1,000 of them and go and meet this woman at 3 in the morning. Y'all all right?
We say, brother. Brother calls us up. Brother, I'm going to go meet this sister and teach her the scripture. No, brother. Bring her to the school. You're a single brother. She's a married sister. Have her come to the school. And why meet her late night? She's a married woman. Where's the husband? I don't know. I guess he's going to be there too. Bro, stop. Stop. There's no married man going to have a Negro come to his house to teach his wife scriptures at midnight. Or 3 in the morning. It ain't happening. So, next Sabbath. What happened, brother? Well, I was in the spirit, because, I study and I can quote and I know all the scriptures are. You know how when you ask for scriptures, I know where everything is. Yeah, bro, you good. So what happened? Well, she answered the door and she had a nightgown on. So did you run? Did you leave? No, I felt that I could handle it. And somehow, while we were going over scriptures, the Bible ended up under the bed. And I ended up on top of the bed. On top of the world. Brother, get the hell out of here. Just get out. Go. These are the things that happen. 21, did you read verse 11?
21, verse 11.
One more time.
He that keepeth the law of the Lord getteth the understanding thereof, and the perfection of the fear of the Lord is wisdom.
And the perfection of the fear of the Lord is wisdom. You got to fear the Most High, because you know that a judgment is coming for your ignoring of God's commandments. Judgment is coming. Give me chapter 20. Watch this. Chapter 20, verse 32 of the same book.
Necessary patience in seeking the Lord is better than he that leadeth his life without a guide.
One more time.
Necessary patience in seeking the Lord.
Stop. In this truth, brothers and sisters, you need patience. Patience is necessary. Some of you want to hop on because I've been lonely for 5 years. So what? Be lonely for 5 more. No! You need patience so you can observe these people. I'm not saying wait 5 years. I know people want to get married. But wait. Wait a year. Wait 2 years if need be. So that you know that she's the one for you or he's the one for you. Wait. You need an argument too. I always say that you need a good fight.
A nasty.
You know why you need to fight? So you know how the other person responds. I got stories on that one too. Some people, you find out, respond violently. You come back to the Sabbath, you're missing a front tooth. Where's your tooth? He knocked it out. You don't want to marry him, sister. That's a sign. When you got in your first fight, he punched you in the face. Don't marry him. Red flag, ring, 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 ring. Don't marry him. Read that again.
Necessary patience in seeking the Lord is better than he that leadeth his life without a guide.
Most Negroes and Latinos want to lead a life without a guide, meaning without the commandments of the Most High. They don't want this. They love the scriptures, Job 9:24. The earth is given into the hand of the wicked. Yeah! Genesis 25:25. The first come I read. Ha ha. Obadiah verse 18. There shall be none remaining. Ha ha. What about thou shalt not commit adultery? I don't want that.
Discipline.
I don't want that. Thou shalt not steal. I don't want that. Mm-mm-mm-mm. I don't want none of that. They cherry pick what they want. We can't be cherry pickers. The Bible is not multiple choice. get your panties circled. I like this one. I like Skister. Yeah, party mix. I don't like that over there, so I'll ignore it. And you'll find out that there's some brothers like that, and there are some sisters like that, too, who cherry pick what they like. What, like, do you ever see these church women? They'll say that they love God, love Jesus, hallelujah. You give them the scriptures. Read the scripture about let the women keep silent. Then you're going to see the face contort. I seen it with my mama. I tried it with her years ago. My mother-in-law, my wife's mother. I said, read this, because she like, I'm damn Jehovah's Witnesses on the corner. Always want to tell you some scripture. I said, what does this scripture, let the women keep... See, no, that's no. No, brother, you don't have the love of Jesus.
Hey, Bishop. You got to expound to the peoples. You told me a situation that you saw years ago. I don't remember exactly where you said you was, but you saw a preacher man, sitting with a Bible, and in his hand was a highlighter, and the highlighter was black.
Yes, that was on the train.
Yes,
that was you on told the me that train. Thing. I couldn't believe it.
He was using a black highlighter.
Right.
Get it?
I'm on a train now. This is years ago. I'm new in the truth, so I like when I would see people with the Bible, I wouldn't go over and see what they're reading or ask, you know, try to share with them what I learned from Sabbath. So I walk over and he's sitting down and I'm standing above him because it was crowded. So I look down and he has the sharp black marker and he's highlighting and I'm noticing his passages just blacked out of his Bible. I said, this dude is the devil. The Bible speaks of.
Now I gotta say something. When you use a highlighter in your Bibles, right, your highlighter goes over the words, whether it's blue, yellow, whatever color the highlighter is, and then you're still able to see the words through the ink. Can you see the words through a black, quote-unquote, highlighter? No. So what was that Negro doing? Blacking out the scriptures. Cherry-picking. He was blacking out the discipline scriptures.
Exactly.
Thou shalt not. They said, no, I don't want that. Thou exactly. shalt not this and that. He was blackening those out. That's a preacher. That's some scary stuff. I just had to bring that up.
But that was good. I'm glad you reminded me of that. Get me Sirach. What did we just read, Captain?
Sirach 20 and 32.
Get 25 and 1. Sirach, I know 25. This 5 and 1.
In three things I was beautified and stood up beautiful both before God and men. The unity of brethren.
So that's one of the most beautiful things. Before God and men. Go ahead.
The love of neighbors.
Love of neighbors, another beautiful thing before God and man.
A man and a wife that agree together.
That's the third beautiful thing. And that's what a lot of new couples don't have. There's no agreement. If there's no agreement when you're just talking to each other, that's a red flag. That person is not for you. There's no agreement.
There's something that has to be mentioned about that thing. Read that thing again.
In three things I was beautified and stood up beautiful before God and men.
Mm-hmm.
The unity of brethren.
The unity of brethren is a beautiful thing. Go ahead.
The love of neighbors.
The love of neighbors is a beautiful thing. But here's the part I want to dwell on.
Man and a wife that agree together.
How much time does it take to find out if the two of y'all agree together? That's not something that's just going to happen in a few weeks. You understand? It takes time. You got to realize something. You got both sides, the man and the woman. They both come out of experiences, came out from different upbringings, sin, all kinds of things that have pertained to both sides. The both of them have to come together and come to an agreement with what the scriptures say to be beautiful. That's what the Lord is talking about in the Bible. So that means that all of those sins that they were involved in prior to that, they have to come to a resolution that we're neither going to deal with this. And the other side said, we're not going to deal with that. We are both going to agree with what the scriptures say. Like the Bible says, for what God have joined together, let no man put asunder. The joining together is meaning that they agree together in the Bible. It takes time for that. That just doesn't happen. All these horny people running around here talking about they just want to get jumping in everybody's pants. It takes time to get to know the other person. You can't rush into that thing.
Now, some of you... Coming as truth married. How many, let me see. How many of you came in the truth married? Raise your hand. Let me see. Okay. See all that? Married already. Now, you came in to Truth Married. Some of you come to Truth Married and find out the two of you don't agree. You don't agree on, hold that up. You don't agree on this. The Bible. You don't agree on this. The two, you come in married. One spouse says, I don't believe that. Thank you, y'all. So they don't believe it. But you are afraid. I'm supposed to talk to you men now. And you women. I'm going to talk to both of y'all. You are afraid, mainly the men. I'll talk to the men. You are afraid that if you make a step against this non-believer, she's going to take half. He said, you know what? I can't deal with it. She's going to take half. Eddie, I want half, Eddie.
You don't want to see that video, do you? So, damn, she saw that. Now she knows she can take half.
Exactly. And that's what a lot of you are. So you stay in miserable. Listen to what I'm saying, you men and women. But I'm talking to men for a reason now. You stay in a miserable relationship. But you're afraid she's going to take half. Give me 1 Ezra 4 and 13. The prophet Zerubbabel discussed women. He said, women, listen good brothers, women are one of the strongest things on earth.
1 Ezra.
That's why there's an expression in the world, shake what your mama gave you. Or use your feminine wiles to get what you want.
I often repeat this, and this is vulgar, but I heard a mother tell a daughter this. You're sitting on $1 million.
Right. Y'all never heard that? Y'all never heard that before? In the South, they say that a lot.
Wicked as hell. Told a daughter that. Said, girl, you should never have to go through X, Y, and Z. You're sitting on $1 million. Training her how to be a complete hoe. Go ahead.
Exactly. Verse 13, please.
1 Ezra chapter 4 and 13. Then the third, who had spoken of woman and of the truth, this was Zerubbabel, began to speak.
Now, Zerubbabel was the king's bodyguard. He was like the secret service of today. His job was to protect the king's life in any situation. So, you know, Zerubbabel had to get down. He could not have been no punk protecting the king of Persia. If y'all see that movie, Tai Chi Master, anybody saw that? Where there was a tournament to be the king's bodyguard. This dude was breaking bones to prove that he was worthy of the job. Because in order to be the king's bodyguard, you couldn't just raise your hand and you picked. No, you had to show what you could do. So this dude, Zerubbabel, had to be bad to be the king's bodyguard. And he was one of the top three. Read that again.
Then the third, who had spoken of woman and of the truth, this was Zerubbabel, began to speak. O ye men, it is not the great king, nor the multitude of men, neither is it wine that excelleth. Who is it then that ruleth them, or hath the lordship over them? Are they not women?
Are they not women? So now Zerubbabel is about to get down and dirty. Now remember, he's speaking before an audience of the Persian Empire, and Israel's there too. So they want to know what's the wisest saying. He begins to talk about women. Now, many of y'all read the scripture, but y'all don't apply nothing it says. This is why y'all always in trouble. Half you in here. Watch. Read on.
Women have borne the king and all the people that bear rule by sea and land. Even of them came they, and they nourished them up that planted the vineyards.
Y'all don't hear women on the street when we're teaching. You don't hear women scream out, eh? You came from a woman? You don't hear them yell that out? They do it all the time because they're telling you they are superior. They're telling you they have the strength. You come from a woman, the woman is superior. That's what she's saying. You came from the woman. But then when you go back to Adam and Eve, Adam did not come from the woman, because that was the discussion with in 1 Corinthians chapter 11 and 8. Go ahead.
Even of them came they, and they nourished them up that planted the vineyards, mm-hmm. from whence the wine cometh. These also make garments for men. These bring glory unto men. And without women cannot men be.
Right. Without women, because people argue about immaculate conception. There's no immaculate conception. The Bible says, except Adam was the only one created from the earth. Everybody else came from women. That's why it says, without women cannot men be. Read.
Yea, and if men have gathered together gold and silver, or any other goodly thing, do they not love a woman which is comely in favor and beauty?
So now, this is why women get so much. Men, we don't, if you ever see men with a lot of money, they will give it all to the woman. Why? Because he, a man's nature is to love that woman. He wants to make sure she is happy, kind, fed, satisfied. Why? Because he wants what she got. Everybody understand that? Watch, read on.
Verse 19. And letting all those things go, do they not gape and even with open mouth fix their eyes fast on her?
You brothers know how we do in the world. Some of y'all do it right now. You see a woman walk by. Some of y'all be at camp and you see the big booty woman walk by and you're in the midst of a scripture and you hear a pause and your head goes to the side like this. Read, brother. Read, brother, read.
Be like, read.
That's why we need discipline. It has taken discipline to not follow that bouncing ball. Go ahead.
Verse 19. And have not all men more desire unto her than unto silver or gold?
See, we don't really, men don't really care about silver and gold as much as he does a woman. Go ahead.
Or any goodly thing whatsoever. A man leaveth his own father that brought him up and his own country and cleaveth unto his wife.
Right. That's what the law said to do. Come on.
He sticketh not to spend his life with his wife and remembereth neither father nor mother nor country.
Mm-hmm. Go ahead.
By this also ye must know that women have dominion over you.
That was my point earlier, that women have dominion over you. Watch.
Do you not labor and toil and give and bring all to the woman?
Let me tell you something. Men work and do all that they do for the woman. For the woman. That's why we bust our butts. Even a drug dealer, he's doing that for some grimy, ratchet woman. Everybody understand that? He's not out there hustling and grinding for himself. He wants some woman. That's what it's for.
How many of y'all agree with that statement? Because raise your hand. Every hand should be up. Because that's the truth.
I'm telling you, go ahead.
Yea, a man taketh his sword and goeth his way to rob and to steal, to sail upon the sea and upon rivers.
Wait, why does this man rob and steal? What is he robbing and stealing for? Woman! Half the Negroes in jail is over a woman.
Hey, wait, I got to give him something. How many of y'all in here married? Watch this. Stick your hands up. How many of y'all have went home or was with at home, I just say at home. Or you come in the house and your wife is mad. She's upset. Do you have a good night after that? I can't hear you. You want to find out what's wrong, what happened. Your whole mind gets changed around trying to figure out what's wrong with her. Come on. Come on, talk to me. Yeah, they're going to sit up there and act like I don't know what I'm talking about. You see this? Gaming. Read the thing again. Read that thing again, because they act like I'm just saying something they don't know about. Read it again.
Yea, a man taketh his sword and goeth his way to rob and to steal, to sail upon the sea and upon rivers.
Finish it. Well, you were going to finish it, right? Okay. All of that, when you read on down, and it says to do what? To give it to his love.
Oh, we're about to read.
Oh, that's what I wanted to get to.
You was ahead of us.
I was ahead of you. Yeah, so I'm ahead of you. So that's what the whole thing is about. All of the wars that he'll go through, he'll risk death. He'll risk jumping in the pit with a lion. He'll risk all of that so that he can go please that woman. So you mean to tell me that you're going to come in the house and your woman is not pleased, you're going to be okay with that? No. You're going to try to find out what's wrong, what's upsetting you. You're going to try to figure all that out. That's what we're reading about here. Y'all all right?
Go ahead.
Verse 24. And looketh upon a lion, and goeth in the darkness, and when he hath stolen, spoiled, and robbed, he bringeth it to his love. Wherefore a man loveth
his... Wait, read that again, verse 24.
And looketh upon a lion, and goeth in the darkness, and when he hath stolen, spoiled, and robbed, he bringeth it to his love.
That's what your point was. He's doing all this for the woman, because he wants the woman, okay? Go ahead.
Wherefore a man loveth his wife better than father or mother. Yea, many there be that have run out of their wits for women and become servants for their sakes.
That's some of you in here. Some of you in here have lost your God-given mind for a woman.
You ain't supposed to go that far.
Right.
That's the point.
And this is the negative.
Right.
He's bringing, you ain't supposed to go that far negative. With
it. If she's being a damn demon, you leave her ass to the cold.
Exactly.
Don't be trying to worry about fixing her up after that. Go ahead.
And you know what? You see the part, yeah, many there be that have run out of their wits for a woman. The woman mad at you.
Right.
You go to sleep. You wake up, and she's looking, she's standing over you. And you scared to death because you don't know what the woman going to do. But you've lost your mind. You don't want to bounce. You scared of what this woman's going to do.
You got to ask them. What would they do? Because I just picture that thing. I picture that thing. Come on. What would you?
Who got hot grits thrown on them? Who was that?
I don't know.
Al Green. I'm telling you. Some of y'all got hot grits thrown. Some of y'all don't even know what I'm talking about, what hot grits is. Let hot grits touch your skin. You're going to scream. And some of you would still stay with that woman because you lost your God-given mind. You crazy. You are crazy. Read that again.
Yay. Many there be that have run out of their wits for woman and become servants for their sake.
Become servants. You become a slave to the woman. You ever see in here? I'm going to give an example up in here. Brother be married. Remember, we even at 1088 last school, we having a meeting about something. In the back, there's a woman, which is brother so-and-so's wife. She gets up. We go, okay, look, here she comes. She goes, she looks at her 300-pound muscle husband, and she goes, he gets up and leaves. Shalom, brother, shalom. I'm like, what the hell is this? Or she throws he's in the meeting. She throws the baby to him so she can go hang out with the sisters. All the men sitting around, we counseling about what city to go to and take down. He got a baby in his hands. And all the men is looking at him like, what the hell is this? Brother, get rid of the baby. Put the baby somewhere. Put the baby in the closet. We can't do God's business. You can't. Wah, wah. And she knows that. But she made a point in front of all the men. He serves me. That was her message to all of us. Ooh, I was sitting there like, what the hell is going on here?
Now, that sounds pretty harsh, right? But is that indeed the message? If you're seeing your husband in counsel and he's dealing with nation matters, why would you even disturb him? Why would you even do that? That's heavy. That's heavy what you just said.
It's about to get heavier. Watch. Read on.
Verse 27. Many also have perished and have erred and sinned for women.
Y'all see that? Many also have perished, have erred, and sinned for women. You ever look at and Jerry goes, so what are you going to do? He goes, well, I guess I have to accept it. That's one episode. Another episode, she'll bring another man into the relationship. She says, well, I'm with him, and if you want to be with me, you're going to accept him. I said, what the hell kind of filth is this? Can you read that verse one more again?
Many also have perished.
Now, we laughing, but somebody up in here is living this. Read it again.
Many also have perished, have erred, and sinned for women.
Uh-huh. The woman goes to the king and takes the crown of his head to send a message.
Right.
He serves me.
Did you hear what it said? The provinces, I forget the word that they use, and they all fear. What was that verse before that?
Verse 28.
What it said?
And now do ye not believe me? Is not the king great in his power?
Is not the king great in his power? Listen to his power. Go ahead.
Do not all regions fear to touch him?
Do not all regions fear to touch him. That's some power. Go ahead.
Yet did I see him and...
Although he has all this power, that's what the yet means. Yet mean I don't give a damn. That's what yet mean. Yet, I don't give a damn. Go ahead.
Yet did I see him and Apami, the king's concubine, the daughter of the admirable Bardicus, sitting at the right hand of the king, and taking the crown from the king's head.
So all this power he has, she said, okay, all of them fear to touch you and all this, but me, I'm going to take the crown from your head. That meant instant death.
Because she's his boo.
Yeah. That would be instant. You know what it's like to take the king's crown from his head? You're saying you're not king anymore.
Mm-hmm. Read again.
And taking the crown from the king's head and setting it upon her own head.
See, these brothers, some women don't do things with no purpose. This is what y'all don't understand before you jump on a woman. There's a purpose why they do certain things.
That is exactly it.
This is what Zerubbabel is saying. When she took the king's crown off his head and put it on her head, she knew what she was doing.
Exactly what she was doing. They're very calculated.
Who would have the nerve to do that?
You don't think she knew about the power, about all the nations and the regions? She knew about all of that. She says, but I got what he wants.
That's right. Go ahead.
Bishop, it's the same thing. Like, we bring counsel to brothers. Sister win when she get home. Yeah, you can tell them whatever you want. When I'm inside the house, I'm the king inside this house. Yeah, you got all these men to help you while you're in here. But when I reach inside the house.
And that's true. That is true, what Elaba just said. That is true. Some brothers be all powerful brothers up in here, but when they go home, they're like a mouse. And, you know, it don't matter how many muscles you got either. Remember, I ain't going to say his name. Remember Big Brother Almighty? And his wife would crush this dude with her mouth. She'd humiliate him. He did, yes, dear. Oh, I can't stand us.
You're trying to figure out that thing, aren't you? Trying to figure that out in your mind. We've seen that thing go down, and we were standing here in pure awe.
Read that again.
And taking the crown from the king's head and setting it upon her own head, she also struck the king with her left hand.
She smacked the hell out of him. She smacked him!
Wait a minute, Bishop, with the left hand?
Yeah, that's more disrespect. Not the right hand, but the left.
The left hand. You know, somebody give you a pound with the left hand. I would say, excuse my left because my right hand is busy. Because
right.
It's a form of disrespect.
Right.
Y'all, when we shalom each other, right? And if I did it with my left hand, I'd be like, I'm sorry because I either, got something in my right hand or something.
In Esau's business world, right. They say, never trust a man who extends his left hand.
Exactly. And that's the scriptures. The most I tell you about the right hand and the left hand. Mm-hmm. The right hand is the righteous side. Okay, when he said that Christ sat on the right-hand side of the Most High. So the righteousness is the right hand. Mm-hmm. So that didn't come from the white man. That's the reason why I said that out there. Y'all all right? But she smacked him with the left.
Right.
Go ahead.
Read on.
And yet for all this, the king gaped and gazed upon her with open mouth.
That's some of you brothers. I'm going to tell you what I mean by that. That's some of you. Some of you met women and they are hitters. You ever meet y'all brothers? Y'all know what I mean by a hitter? They like to hit you. I hate that. My wife, don't hit me. I don't like that. Bishop, I don't hit you.
Right.
You don't hit me.
Bishop.
I don't want
right. I want to go into the word gape. What does that word gape mean? Gape. Read it again.
And yet, for all this, the king gaped and gazed upon her with open mouth.
So not only did he gaze and with her with open mouth, but it said, but he gaped. What does the word gape mean? Look it up. Because I'm already imagining what the word gape. See, you gotta ponder on the words. What does that word gape mean? It says, read it again, Captain. Oh, okay, you got the definition, I guess.
Yeah, it says, stare with one's mouth open wide, typically in amazement or wonder.
See, all that went down. Meaning he was intellectually shut down. Something had happened and he did not know what to do. He was in a state of suspended confusion. That's what he was. That's how he was. That's what it means to gape with his mouth open. He was like stuck. They didn't get that. Some of them looking at
because they get smacked at home.
They didn't get it. Read the thing again, Captain Isaac, the scripture.
And yet, for all this, the king gaped.
Stop. What? The king gaped. He can't believe what just happened. But he didn't do anything because he's like, this is my punani. Mm-hmm. So he was suspended. I know I need to knock her head off. But I can't do it. That's the gape. So you got to dramatize that thing. All right, go ahead.
And yet for all this, the king gaped and gazed upon her with open mouth. If she laughed upon him, he laughed also.
But right. Stop. If she laughed upon him, he laughed also. You ever hear And this is how women know when you want her. If she says something stupid as hell, no matter how bad, you go, you crazy. You just, that ain't funny. She's stupid. But you don't want to say, hey, that was stupid what you said. You want to please us.
That's it. That's it right there.
And your brothers and the women do that with you. You say something dumb and ignorant, and she go, hey, you so crazy. No, damn well, that was stupid as hell. Go ahead.
If she laughed upon him, he laughed also. But if she took any displeasure at him, the king was fain to flatter.
He would flatter her if she was upset.
That she might be reconciled to him again.
That he might win her back to his graces again. Go ahead.
Oh, ye men, how can it be but women should be strong, seeing they do thus? Then the king and the princes looked one upon another. So he began to speak of the truth.
Y'all see that? Then the king and the princes looked one upon another. Because they were shocked that Zerubbabel had the nerve to put the king on blast in front of the empire. And he did it in front of millions of people. That's how our forefather got that. I'm going to put the king on blast right now. Because he knew the Most High was with him. Watch this. From there, get me Sirach 25:13.
Give me any plague but the plague of the heart, and any wickedness but the wickedness of a woman.
I'm not even going to break it down. Watch this. Give me Ecclesiastes 7:26. In the Bible, Ecclesiastes, not Ecclesiasticus, Ecclesiastes 7:26. Then I'm going to tell you why I'm hitting these scriptures. I'm about to reveal it. I got to talk about it.
Ecclesiastes chapter 7 and verse 26. And I find more bitter than death the woman whose heart is snares and nets and her hands as bands.
Wait, did we just freeze out? Dang. I need a haircut. Every time I look at this picture. Read that again.
And I find more bitter than death.
Listen, brothers, listen good. Solomon, the wisest king in the world, said, I find more bitter than death. Come on.
The woman whose heart is snares and nets.
Whose heart is snares and nets. That's the type of woman he finds more. In the old school, we used to just end it at woman. And say God hates women, but that ain't what it's saying. It says he hates the woman whose heart, meaning whose mind, is snares and nets, meaning a trap. She thinks of ways to trap you up.
Why is she more bitter than death? Think about that scripture that he just read. Whose heart is, read it again, Captain.
And I find more bitter than death the woman whose heart is snares and nets.
Stop. Why would this woman be considered more worse than death? Because the woman that it's talking about would be your woman, per se, so you can understand. Go ahead. Who can answer that? You up front.
Shalom, leadership.
Think about all what the bishop brought out, all the scripture that he brought out, because it correlates with my question.
Okay. the woman... That'd be bitter than death. Death will be quick. But this woman gonna be your wife, and this woman is also for your whole life living with her. She gonna be bitter.
Meaning, because she's the closest thing to you.
She's exactly.
You follow me? Yes, that's why. Because it's no. She's there with you. She knows your ins and outs. She knows your whole that she studied you in, and so she's with you all the time, so to speak. She's the closest thing to you and studied you.
Read that again.
And I find more bitter than death the woman whose heart is snares and nets and her hands as bands. Whoso pleaseth God shall escape from her.
Read that bottom piece up again.
Whoso pleaseth God shall escape from her.
One more time.
Whoso pleaseth God shall escape from
brothers,
her.
Brothers, I want us all to say that precept again. Read it. Let's read it together. Read it.
Whoso pleaseth God shall escape from her.
That's it right there.
Now I'm going to talk about Texas Pete. You brothers. Here come brother in the truth. His wife says, I don't believe that Bible. I reject that Bible. But baby, I love you. I love you. Can we be, come on, baby, let's stay together. She says, no, I'm not doing that. I like Christmas. I like Easter. I like Easter eggs. I like Kwanzaa. I like everything but what that Bible says. I like white folks. I like pork. I like shrimp. Baby, baby, please, baby, please. Let's reason together. She says, true story. She's going, oh, you want to reason together? She said, well, what are you doing? He says, baby, it's the feast of unleavened bread. I have to take all the leaven out of the house. She says, don't touch my bread. I bought that bread. You put that bread right back down. I don't care if they got leaven in it. You leave it. Are you touching my stuff? She gets a bottle of Texas Pete hot sauce.
Y'all don't know about Texas Pete, don't you?
Put a picture of Texas Pete.
Who's from, before they put it up, who's from the southern part of the country?
Nobody.
I see one hand back there. My goodness. See, y'all will get hit in the head with all kinds of things and won't know what's going on. Texas Pete is a famous hot sauce that they make down south. It's got this this cowboy red with the chaps on it. It's a very famous hot sauce that they put on different kinds of abominations and all that. Mm-hmm. Y'all know what I'm talking about.
They put that all on pork feet, pig feet,
and chitlins and all. That's how they eat it.
There you go.
There it is.
That's Texas.
And the reason why I said that, this is because they come in big bottles. Mm-hmm. They're not all small. They got the little small one, and they got the real big one.
Yep.
Go ahead.
Well, sister girl, bust the brother upside the head, put him in a hospital.
With Texas Pete?
With Texas Pete.
She ain't get the cheap, because they got cheap hot sauces down there too, but she going to hit him with Texas Pete.
He getting stitched up on the phone calling the brothers.
Brothers.
Yeah, she bust me upside the head with Texas Pete. Come on, stop. Can't Isaac delight that precept again?
Whoso pleaseth God shall escape from her.
That's why some of you brothers your idea is not to please God. Your idea is to please the woman. So you stay in an abusive, because when some of you men, not just y'all, some men live in an abusive relationship. And I know, brothers, you are afraid to admit your wife beat you. Some of you are like that. I don't care how bad you speak on the street. Some of you, where's the camera online? Some of you brothers online, you know your wife beats you. And you bad. You big brother almighty brothers. And get beat and hit upside the head with Texas Pete. Here go another one, Laba. You know this one. Brother come in the house. Hard day at work. His wife is on the phone with her girlfriend. She says, true story, I'm not lying, I'm not making this up. She says to her girlfriend on the phone, here come that nigga now. He says, what?
He said what?
Yeah, because he heard her say to her girlfriend on the phone, here come that nigga now.
What's wrong with that statement? What's wrong with that statement? Come on, quick. No, that's not the part. All right, but I'm going to give it back to you, bitch. I'm tired of interrupting you. You. Who's got it? Yeah, this brother's standing up.
She was talking about him. Shalom. She was talking about him before he got home. She's on the phone talking about him.
Should he be surprised? That's my point.
That she said that about him?
Exactly.
No.
No. So why is he why is he acting like that? That's an everyday occurrence. Yeah. That's my point. Yes.
But the story goes on. True story. He starts cursing her out while she's drinking some soda. Guess what she does with the soda bottle? Bust him upside the head with the soda bottle. He, in response, grabs her, picks her up, and body slams her in the glass and drags her.
Oh. So he
this was Connecticut.
Yeah.
Now what happens after that? She cursing, all kind of abominable words is being thrown. And this is a hood rat girl. Some of you brothers are married to hood ratchet women. She says, you gonna do that to me? I'm gonna call my boys. And they gonna F you up.
How many of y'all know about that, what the bishop just said? Some of these women are so damn wicked, they'll get niggas to beat up their husbands. I've seen that thing.
And you know how they do it? She laid down I can't use. What she did to them
in
the dark.
Right. I've known some situations where the woman sold drugs for the niggas. And was still married to the brother. Y'all didn't hear what I said. Ran drug deals for the drug dealer nigga while she was still married to a dude at home. So he really had the woman on check. He called up, I need a run here, I need this, I need, and while she was married. And if he did not conform to whatever she wanted, which is what he really wanted, she would get niggas to beat his ass.
So you know what he did? He did like some of you might do. He ran. Ran to a brother's apartment and hid there for months. Laba, you know what I'm talking about. In hiding. Out of fear. Some of y'all are in relationships like that. And you are, give me the wind scripture. Give me the wind. You're trying to hide this thing. Give me the wind scripture. Who knows what it is? Somebody help me. He that with a wicked woman can't hide the wind. Yeah, that
the
one.
Ointment.
Somebody help me. Now, I could point at a few brothers who I know is going through this, but I don't want to embarrass the brother. So I'll just do this. And you don't write me and say, well, you're talking about me. Yes, I'm talking about you. You punk fried brother. The hell is this? I'm the type of guy black women did not want to arrive to deal with their problem. That was me. I arrived to the scene, and I see the brother like this, with blood all on his shirt. His head is bleeding too. I said, what happened? Who called? He says, I called. I said, who did that to you? He says, she did that to me. She said, yeah, I did it to him. He, that nigga ain't no damn good. She, all kind of stuff. So some rookies came. So I didn't have to deal with it. So they said, what to do? I said, lock her black ass up. Excuse my French. She was like, no, what? Wait. See, they like when white cops come, because the white cops, they would lock up the black boy who's bleeding on the ground.
Right. That's what she wanted to show up.
Exactly.
She wanted him to show up.
Read that. Where we at? Read
Proverbs that. 27 and 15. A continual dropping in a very rainy day and a contentious woman are alike.
Just wait. You got you at home, and there's a water. You ever see a drop from the ceiling, and you got to put it in a can to block it, and that noise is so damn annoying. Because all through the night, blip, 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 it's annoying. God is saying, read it again.
A continual dropping in a very rainy day, and a contentious woman.
An argumentative woman.
Are alike.
She likes to argue. Some of you brothers in here are with women who like to argue.
Bishop.
Over nothing.
Exactly. That's what the scripture meant when we read earlier, more bitter than death. Because she's like that continual dropping in your ear. Annoying. Just bringing pure hell to you.
Now, you would have wanted, if you had proof, if there was a cartoon, A$AP, you might remember, if Johnny had gone to the police, this would have never happened. If you had just proved the woman, you wouldn't be in that miserable relationship you're in now. And God gives you a way out. God says, if you will please me, do what, brothers? Escape. See, some brother, I noticed only five brothers said it. The ones that didn't say nothing, you know.
Some of them got kids.
Yeah, there you go. I got brother, you don't understand. I got kids with this woman. She's on my bank account. She's this with me. Okay, well, you stay there and get abused.
I don't think.
Then watch this. Wait. Some of you have gone to jail. Some of you in here have gone to jail after you were given counsel. Leave that hoe alone. She hate God and she hate you. Brother, I'm going to make it work. Next thing you know, we get the call. How are you getting jail? Well, brother, we got an argument that led to a fight. I put hands on the woman. That's a woman, an evil woman will lead you. She'll go, hit me, nigga, hit me. She know what she's doing. Provoke you. You just want to do get it out. Just you did it one time. Now you got the cuffs on you. Now you got a court date.
Got 911 on speed dial.
When you have been given counsel, leave her. God, read it again. What did God say? He that pleaseth God shall, what would it say? Escape from her. Why? Nobody can understand that. You brothers come here miserable. Miserable. Yeah. Go ahead, Lama.
Read that scripture again.
A continual dropping. In a very rainy day, and a contentious woman are alike.
Now, read that scripture. Say, he that feared the God, he that will escape from her.
Ecclesiastes 7 and verse 26. Mm-hmm. Whoso pleaseth God shall escape from her, mm-hmm. but the sinner shall be taken by her.
Yep. You know, when it said he that so fear God shall escape by her, meaning that the other man that is in you said, I don't have no choice. But the godly man that is in you said, hey, hell with that, I'm out. Brother, you got a place where I can squeeze for a couple of months? Mm-hmm. This thing here, I cannot take it. Because you know that fear God, you can do. I don't want this brother crib for a while until you get in your feet. But you don't feel, yeah, damn, how could I do that? That while you still messing with that woman, the next thing you know, you're in jail. Or next thing you know, you beat her so bad where the cops, you know what I mean, you kill her. You understand? Then you used to push her. She never fell. This time you just touch her. She fell. She died. You know, you see what I'm saying
and
to you?
And hit her head on the sink.
Right. Boop. Right.
Oh, God, right. Jesus.
You know what's heavy? You know what's heavy? We said this around the beginning of the class. We said that a lot of people hear us bringing the scriptures out, read these scriptures, break them down and all of that, and people still don't listen. That scripture said that she's worse than death. Mm-hmm. And here you coming up with an excuse talking about some damn kids. You don't know what death is. Death meaning that's it.
She will kill you, brother.
You're going to die.
You see that bottom precept, it said, but the sinner. What does it say?
They don't get it.
It says, but the sinner shall be taken by her.
You know what, brothers? If you stay in an abusive relationship, you're revealing that you are what, brother?
That's it.
A sinner. Did I just make that up? What did I say?
But the sinner shall be taken by her.
Because the sinner will not apply nothing he has read in the Bible. Right. He will stay with that contentious woman.
Make excuses and all that and stay with her.
Can I add something, Bishop?
Yeah.
Could you go to Proverbs chapter 21, verse 19?
Proverbs.
This is proof. The bishop just explained to you that the keys to dealing with this woman, because some of you, like the bishop said, you're going to hide this demon, this monster. You're going to hide her. And you're weak and you're evil and you don't believe in this truth. But this is what the scripture said.
It is better to dwell in the wilderness.
Where?
In the wilderness.
There's no furniture. You can't get your clothes washed. You're sleeping on a rock. The sun is beating down on your head.
No running water.
No running water. Read it again.
It is better to dwell in the wilderness.
Read on.
Than with a contentious.
What kind of woman?
A contentious.
That's the type of woman that the bishop is talking about. Some women love contention. They look for anything to argue about. Read on.
And an angry woman.
And their spirit is angry all the time, especially for the word of the Most High. And we've seen it here when brothers have come to us and describe the type of dragon they have at home. And I usually ask them, well, what level is she? Is it a level 3, a level 4, a level 6? And once we realize that she's a level 6 demon, which means you cannot fix her, that's when we start to tell them. The brothers who come to me, I tell them, look, you got to leave. I'm not going to argue with her. I don't want to see you go to jail. And we're not going to go back and forth because she's built for arguing. So the first thing I tell them is, yo, you got to leave.
Yeah, Deacon Aesop. That means the scripture you mean it's better to be living in a shelter.
That's right.
And dealing with
in your car. In a shelter, in your car, in your friend's basement. The scriptures is telling you it's better to get out than to stay there. But the bishop said a very powerful thing. The only reason why you stay is because you a wicked nigga. That's right. Because how could you be around a woman that's breaking all the commandments and you keep your mouth shut and you hide it? You're a weak man. And you do not deserve the kingdom. And Satan knows what he's doing. Satan already said, who, him? I got something for him. I'm going to rock his world. And then you get that woman from Martin. What's her name again? I mean, from The Living Color.
Oh, Living
from
Color.
The Living Color, remember? When she would tell him, I'll rock your world.
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah.
Yeah, Bishop, you remember this sister? She been trying a long time to have her husband in here. Long time, sister, trying. She called me. She called, a few sisters, a few brothers beside me. And one time she called me, she said, I just caught my, I went over to my mom's house for a while. Then my husband cheated on me. But remember, the husband is an unbeliever. Mm-hmm. Then she said, maybe what you think I should do, Deacon Laba? Maybe I should give him something so he can start. I just want to hang up the phone on her sister's face. But to show on you, like the bishop just said, it's not only the husband ain't right. The sister ain't right.
That sister ain't right. That sister ain't right either. Mm-hmm.
Go back to Proverbs 27 and verse, what verse was that? 15?
Proverbs 27, verse 15. A continual dropping in a very rainy day and a contentious woman are alike.
Go ahead.
Whosoever hideth her, hideth the wind.
Y'all see that? Any brother in here, can you hide the wind? No. It said what was that again?
Whosoever hideth her, hideth the wind.
Brothers, you can't hide a wicked woman. Even if you don't never bring her around the congregation, it's going to come out that she's wicked. The fact that she don't show up tells that's, us she's exactly. wicked. No matter if you lie for her and say, oh, she had to work. She couldn't that's get right. off work. Then when we get to call that you're in jail, go, there you go. Or you in a hospital getting stitches in your head because Texas Pete bust you upside the head. We know, oh, he's married to the devil. And he's hid it for years. Go ahead.
And the ointment of his right hand, which bewrayeth itself.
Can you you put ointment on your right hand. Can you hide the smell that comes off? You can't. What's that smell? Yeah, everybody going to know you put an ointment on your hand. So God is comparing a wicked woman. He says you can't hide it. Everyone's going, I smell evil. Yeah, I smell sulfur. The devil is here. What verse was that, Captain Isaac?
Verse 16.
Verse 16. Now, that was it. From there, get me Sirach 25:16. Did we read that one yet?
No, sir. No.
Let's read that.
I had rather dwell with a lion and a dragon than to keep house with a wicked woman.
Do y'all know a lion is a man-eating creature? It will eat you. The prophet said, I would rather live with an animal like that than a wicked woman. Read it again. That's some heavy stuff. And he said, did he say a dragon? Do you know a dragon is a fire-breathing man-eater? Like in the movie The Hobbit. What was that? Smaug? Remember that big dragon? That's the right movie? Smaug the Magnificent. Huh? Lord of the Rings. Yeah.
Bishop, he's saying you can reason with the lion and you can reason with the dragon.
Right.
But you cannot reason with the black woman.
Read that again.
I had rather dwell with a lion and a dragon than to keep house with a wicked woman.
Y'all see that? And in order for y'all to know that if she's wicked or not, you have to do what, brothers? You got to prove her. Some of y'all skip over that. Then you get caught. You get caught. And we have given you scriptures after scriptures to help you. Was that it, Captain? Read on.
The wickedness of a woman changeth her face.
Stop! Her face will change. Just look at the countenance. When she met you, it was all teeth and smiles.
Not like peppermint.
Now when she see you, she got the scowl of death. Always a screw face when she's looking at you. She want to punch you in the face now. She hates your guts. Why'd I get with this dude? He don't work. Now, that's the negative side of it, because that might be why she's mad, because you don't work. You's a bum. It might be that, but this, I'm doing the other way. It ain't that. She's just the devil. Right, because you're bringing scriptures out, and she hates your guts for it. Let's use that one. Go ahead.
The wickedness of a woman changeth her face and darkeneth her countenance.
Darkeneth her countenance. She always got a black cloud on her head. Here she come to bear of bad news. Go ahead.
And darkeneth her countenance like sackcloth.
Mm-hmm.
Her husband shall sit among his neighbors, and when he heareth it, shall sigh bitterly.
Some of you brothers are like that. We'll be sitting down, and brother, it might be Captain Apart. Brother, can you talk to your wife? Up in here. Brother, can you talk to your wife? She's threatening the children. Brother, can you talk to your wife? She's cursing sisters out. And you brothers, oh God, freaking shit. And we see you. Some of you powerful brothers up in here. And then your wife, oh, I'm sorry, I didn't mean to embarrass my husband. Yes, she did. She's letting everybody know she runs you. Yeah.
That brother was in a good spirit, laughing, having a good time. Soon he heard that, the whole joy disappeared.
Y'all think we making, we're not making nothing up. It's all reality. This is a reality check. What verse was that, Captain?
That was verse 18.
Go ahead.
All wickedness is but little to the wickedness of a woman.
All wickedness is but little to the wickedness of a woman. God is letting us know you don't know the depth she will go. When she hates your guts, how low will she go? We just gave the example. How do you think the woman got all the dudes in a ghetto, the project, to beat her husband up? Because she blew half of them off. She done rocked half their world.
As nasty as that sounds, that's what be going down. I'm telling you, straight up.
I got a story. I told y'all this story before, but I got stories.
They call them the Project Hope.
Yeah.
That's the word today. That's the name of it. They call them the Project. They actually had a song on it. I was in the rap game. I used to spin the records.
Used to rap?
No. It's just with the turntables and all that. And I remember how I used to spin that record. She's the Project Hope.
I got a story. I got to tell a story. Y'all know this. I've told it several times. Woman gets robbed. Home invasion. Robbed. She's coming. She's, I got robbed. And they did this to me. And they did that to me. And the husband's going, baby, calm down. Everything's going to be okay. Can y'all help? You know, they did this to me. They robbed me. They took all my stuff. They beat me up, too. Really? Okay. Let's go check this out. So, first thing you do, you go back to the scene. Oh, look, there's a video camera. Oh, look, and there's another one right there. Like, okay, let's pull the tapes. Pull the video. So now they out. No, we're looking at the video. Put it on the screen. You see the woman come up the stairs in the project, and you see a guy. She's talking with a guy in the hall, right, who she couldn't remember what he looked like. He goes up to the roof. Because the next floor was the roof. He goes up by himself to the roof. She goes up behind him to the roof. Male goes up. Another male comes, goes up to the roof. So what the hell's going on there? Another man goes up to the roof. Three men go up to the roof with her on the roof. She didn't come. They all up there. First man comes down. He's pulling up his zipper. Second man comes down. He's pulling up his zipper. Third man comes down. He's pulling up his zipper. They go in the apartment, bust it in, beat the husband up, rob everything. Woman comes down. She sees them on tape run by her. You see them run by her. Then she goes into action. Okay, that's what she calls 911. So now we call them in the room. Young lady, is this something you want to tell us about the situation?
No, it's just a horrible situation.
Are you sure? Is there something you want to tell
us? Now, she's unaware of video.
Right.
She's unaware of the cameras, because that's the way Negroes get busted. You understand? I work in the field and I didn't know that camera was there. It always happens that way.
So, now, the husband is there. She's there. So, buddy goes, you sure there's anything you want to bring out? You want to tell us what happened? And you don't remember what they look like?
No, I don't know. I can't. It happened so fast.
Roll the video. And you see that you got to see the husband's face. The eyes is like this bigger than yours. Big eyes. Eyes like huge. Like what the heck? And the mouth is open. He sees three guys coming down, zipping up their pants.
He's gaped.
And he sees the wife coming down like this. Give me that scripture. You know the mouth scripture. Wipe that one. Where's that one? Sirach 26:12. Read that. This is it. See, the Bible covers everything. You might not like it, but the Bible talks about everything.
Sirach 26:12. She will open her mouth.
Oh, she opened her mouth all right.
As a thirsty traveler.
Mm-hmm.
When he hath found a fountain and drink of every water near her. By every hedge will she sit down and open her quiver against every arrow.
I want the other one. It says a wicked woman wipes her mouth. Proverbs what? 30 and 20. Give me that one. Proverbs 30 and 20.
Such is the way of an adulterous woman. She eateth and wipeth her mouth and saith, I have done no wickedness.
She does wickedness wiping her. Why is she wiping her mouth? Because she did. Anyway, she wiping her mouth, said, I ain't do nothing wrong. That's what this hoe did. So the husband begins screaming, cursing, And a woman's looking, and she's looking. She's looking at the husband. She looks at us. She looks at the husband. She looks at us. Then she goes to the husband. They're trying to break up our marriage. Oh, don't listen to that. I'm sitting with this mother. The hell? And the husband was so weak. He goes, after he curses her out, he goes, you know what? Baby, it's all right. It's all right. And I'm saying, what the hell? The Negro is a phenomenon. He was created, like you say, in a laboratory in America.
He was special made. He fell off the table while it was. That damn thing is a mess, man. That is a pure mess.
It is.
But she knew how destroyed he was.
Exactly.
That's the reason why she did that wickedness in the first place, because she knew he was stupid as hell.
And for you brothers, let me tell you something. You quiet brothers who are, and you know who you are, I ain't got a point at you. You know if you're quiet, mild-mannered, soft brothers, you get a dominant sister who's interested in you. And she's telling you, you got muscles for days. She's flattering you. And you think she's in love with, brother, stop. You talk like this. You go, shalom, sister. She goes, shalom, brother. Shalom. She wants you. Let me see. Who? Why do you think she wants you? Why do you think she wants that mild-mannered, quiet brother who's so soft-spoken? Why does she want you? Right, Obadiah. Let me see what you got.
Shalom.
Shalom.
Because she knows she could take control of you.
That's right. She knows she can rule you and dominate you. It's just like the older woman, young man syndrome. Same thing. Older woman goes, I want, here she is, 35, and you are 19, about to be 20. I want him. And you are just so, she wants me. She doesn't want you because she's in love with you. She says, I can rule him. Right, conquest.
She wants the weak man inside of you.
Exactly. And there'll be another brother who's got his own stuff together. Powerful brother. Loud. She goes, no, I don't want him. Mm-mm. There was a sister that was with us that said to Bishop Kanai, y'all know what I'm talking about. She said to Bishop Kanai, she said, I could. And her husband was sitting right
listen,
there.
Listen to this.
She said, I could never be married to a man like you. So Kanai said, because I'm a real man. So, and the husband's sitting right there.
Can y'all believe that? Look at that. They're shaking their head. They can't believe this thing happened.
Right. Because she knew she was looking for somebody she could say, shut up, sit down, go over there, do this. Some not all women. I ain't saying all of them like that. But there's some women who look for that. She can smell weakness. Oh, he's whooped. He's weak. I got him. I don't care how old y'all either. Now, some of y'all looking at me angry. I see the angry faces. I know this side of the room. Some of them mad. Give me, go back to Sirach 25. Did we finish that? I'll be mad. 25. Did we finish 19?
Yes, we did.
Okay, yes. Give me 1 Corinthians 7 and 15. Y'all still want to read verse 23?
Read 23.
Sirach 25 and
this
verse 20.
Again, this is going along with all what the bishop read out of Ecclesiastes 7:26 and the rest of the scriptures that he brought up. Read this.
A wicked woman abateth the courage, making an heavy countenance and a wounded heart. A woman that will not comfort her husband in distress maketh weak hands and feeble knees.
Who can explain this in correlation with what we've been going over? And the reason why I say in what we've been going over, because I want to make sure that you brothers retain the information that comes out from this podium. And I'm keen on that because, like I said before, we do a lot of teaching, bring a lot of things out, and it seems to go in one ear and out the other. I want to make sure that y'all can retain what's being taught up here. See if you can connect this to what we've been going over earlier. Who's got it? Brother with his hand up right here with the glasses. Let's read that scripture again for him, Captain.
A wicked woman abateth the courage, maketh an heavy countenance and a wounded heart.
Stop right there. You on.
All right, so
in the context of what we talked about.
In the context of what we're talking about, The scriptural counsel is for you to prove a friend, always, first and foremost. And so if you make the mistake of not proving a friend and you get involved with this woman, she could turn out to be wicked and she can take your strength from you. She can dominate you or rule over you. If she's a wicked woman, she can make your life, worse.
A living hell, right?
Exactly. So
another part where it said her whose mind is as snares and traps and all that. All that's covered in this part right here. Read the rest of that, Captain.
A woman that will not comfort.
No, I mean, I'm sorry. A wicked woman maketh a.
A wicked woman abateth the courage.
What does it mean to abate the courage? The reason why I'm going over it, I'm sorry, Bishop. The reason why I want it, because I really want your brothers to understand what it means to get involved with the wrong woman and stay with her. You got to understand what this woman will cause you. When we was reading about she's worse than death, we're reading about death here. All of this right here pertains to that death. Read.
A wicked woman abateth the courage.
What does that part mean?
It means a wicked woman will.
A man is supposed to be courageous.
Yes.
When he's with a wicked, no good, skank woman, you won't have no courage to do nothing. You become a damn feline piece of weak cat kitten when you're supposed to be a lion. You understand? That makes you miserable in your spirit. You understand?
Yes.
You're supposed to have the lion. You're supposed to have a austere posture about yourself. You get with some of these women, you won't feel like nothing. You feel like a little kitten. Go ahead, read.
Maketh in heavy countenance.
Maketh us, you always sad and broken in the spirit. That's what we be dealing with, Bishop. Mm-hmm. Broken men. Men, battered men. What the hell is this? Battered men. Broken men. Come on.
And a wounded heart.
And a wounded heart. Don't have the courage to do anything. He's weak. Go ahead.
A woman that will not comfort her husband in distress maketh weak hands and feeble knees.
A woman's supposed to be a pillar of strength to you. That's what the scriptures say. But that's not what we're reading here. She's making, what it say? Maketh weak hands and feeble knees. You're like a little mush puppy. It's horrible. That's worse than death to me. I'd rather be dead. I don't want to live like this. Go ahead.
Remember that expression in the world that says, behind every good man is a strong
woman. Exactly. They always say that. But they're getting that out of the scripture that we just quoted about being a pillar.
Exactly. Exactly. Get 1 Corinthians 7:15. See, even in the New Testament, the Most High tells you, brothers, if you are, and we know if your wife is, if she don't show up, she's wearing pants, she's celebrating Christmas, got Christmas garlands all in the house. We know you got Easter eggs all in the house. We know she's wicked. This is what the Bible says. 1 Corinthians 7:15.
1 Corinthians 7:15. But if the unbelieving depart, let him depart. A brother or a sister is not under bondage in such cases. But God hath called us to peace.
Let's read that verse again.
But if the unbelieving depart, let him depart.
The unbeliever doesn't accept these scriptures. God says, let them go. Go ahead.
A brother or a sister.
So it's either or. God says, if the brother got an unbelieving wife, let her go. If a sister got an unbelieving husband, let him go. Go ahead.
Is not under bondage.
You're not under the bondage of marriage.
So what if there's kids involved?
You're not under the bondage of
marriage. I wanted him to repeat that because some people get stupid and try to bring things into God's scripture like it's going to change, like Deacon Laba was saying. None of that garbage is going to change what the Bible says.
Y'all what's up?
Yeah.
The kids are collateral damage. You know when Esau go to war?
We call them casualties of war.
That's right. They casualties of war. Certain things just get damaged. And the reason why I'm saying that is because to save your house, you're going to have to take that loss sometimes. And some of you will make your decisions emotional, saying, oh, I'm staying for the kids, and you do more damage to the kids. I had someone say to me, they were complaining because they said, I grew up in my household without a parent or whatever. So when I asked about the parent is wicked as hell. And I said, look, brother, you're better off because that parent wasn't here. You could have grew up in that house and you wouldn't even have been in the truth. So don't always look at this fight to keep everything together when it's not working. And a lot of times some of you are that emotional, especially with the women. There's certain women who I will not counsel with. Because they're saying to me, my Lord, my Lord, my Lord. And he ain't nothing but a black devil that the Bible speaks of. And she calling him her Lord. And you expect me to keep counseling with him. He's smoking weed. He's messing around with other people. He don't want nothing to do with the scriptures. But you're telling me he's your Lord.
He's in the strip clubs.
He's in the strip club. Okay? And you're giving, that's a high title for you to honor someone as your Lord. And if you're calling him your Lord in this evil, then you don't believe in the Bible. You're just going through the motions, so go back to the Christian church where they allow it. You here pretending to be an Israelite, and there's a lot of people doing that. Men and women. You got demon spouses that you're attached to, and you just want to stay here and play pretend. And you are not getting no kingdom.
Right. Let me help some of these sisters out that got husbands who go to strip clubs, and then they say, oh, my Lord, ask questions. Is he pleased to dwell with me? And listen, no! If your husband is in strip clubs committing adultery, and you're sitting, you women know about it.
That's right.
He's my Lord. You're a fool.
You're dumb. You're a stupid idiot. That's why I don't take their phone calls and I don't talk to them.
Let me help him out. I'm going to give him a movie. This is a movie you sisters who are in those relationships need to watch. Julia Roberts starring in Sleeping with the Enemy. Watch the movie. Her husband, watch this, was the devil. Very abusive. She said, now how can I get away from this nigga? What she did, she started studying how to swim.
Oh, that's Jennifer Lopez.
No. Julia Roberts. Okay. But that's very similar to...
Yes.
That's called Enough. That movie. Right.
Both of them, at least Esau knew to put the movie together
right.
To let the woman have some common sense.
Exactly. So Julia Roberts couldn't swim. She went to swim school every summer. But the husband never knew.
Yes. I remember that one now. The key thing was, all through the movie, she was planning her escape.
Right.
Instead of complaining to everybody else, because some of the women, they just want to yap in everybody's ear. But I love him.
Right.
But the kids, but how long we've been together. Meanwhile, he's destroying the kids and everything that they put together. Right.
Digging ASAP, why do they go to the other sisters and be complaining?
For the air of sympathy?
Because they want the sisters to tell them to stay there.
Yeah.
That's the only reason why they do it. Because if they like what you're getting ready to bring out, that was a real solution. Huh? They want to hear somebody say, no, baby, try to work it out.
Yes.
So she got on the ship with her husband.
Right.
It was a storm. She got knocked in the water. She threw herself in. And she swam to shore. So the husband thought she was dead. So she went and lived. She had saved money. You know how you give your wife money? She saved everything. She ain't spent nothing. Helping you sisters out. Stored that money, swam away. She got a new life, changed her name, everything.
Yep, changed her hair, everything.
Exactly. Now, the husband found out because he found out. Somebody said, oh, your wife was an excellent swimmer. He met the swim instructor by accident. And the husband said, my wife couldn't swim. He said, yeah, she would come every summer, and I taught her how to swim. She was like, what? So now he's starting to put until he went after her. He found out. But anyway, it's a good movie. Look at it for you scaredy cat sisters with those demon husbands you got at home. Now, did we 1 Corinthians? No. 2 Esdras 14:14. This, I'm going back to you men now. And this goes for the women too. I always ask, why do they stay in these miserable, abusive relationships? Now, listen good to what I'm about to say. I'm not saying you argue, because you're going to argue. When you read in the Bible, did Abraham argue with Sarah? Yes. Did Tobit argue with his wife? Yeah, you read about it all through the Bible. David and Bathsheba argued. David and his other wife argued. That's there. That's not what we're talking about. We're talking about you're miserable because she's a miserable piece of turd and wants to make you miserable. Hates your guts. Read that. 2 Ezra 14:14.
Let go from thee mortal thoughts.
Right. Mortal thoughts like what about the children? Go ahead.
Cast away the burdens of man.
Cast away the burdens of man. Go ahead.
Put off now the weak nature.
Put off now the weak nature. You brothers, put off. Now, the weak nature is really talking about the sin nature. But in that sin nature is, I don't know what to do. I'm confused. I think I should stay with her. Yeah, she busts me upside the head with a Texas Pete bottle, but I should stay because I love her. That's weak. That's the weak nature. The Bible says, put that off from you. God can't use you in this battle coming, in this war. Read it again.
Let go from thee mortal thoughts. Cast away the burdens of man. Put off now the weak nature. And set aside the thoughts that are most heavy unto thee.
Set aside the thoughts that are most heavy unto thee. What about the kids? You got to put them thoughts away. Do what you got to do to survive. The kids going to be okay. They're going to be all right. If you believe there's a God, they're going to be all right. Okay? Now, talk about you single mothers just for a second. Women, single mothers say, I don't know if the brother likes me. Brother said, I like the sister, but she got kids. You got to ask, there's a few questions you need to ask to determine, brothers, if you want to marry a sister who has children. You might want to write this down. Question number one, where's the baby daddy? Where is he? You meet a sister in Israel because we got single parents. Where's the baby daddy? Is he A, dead? Is he B, incarcerated? And if he's incarcerated, for how long? Or is he transient? Is he on the move? Just Papa was a Rolling Stone. Is he one of those type of guys? You got to ask those three questions.
Dead is the best answer.
Exactly. You want to hear he's dead. Incarcerated, it might be for 2 years. Then the Negro coming out, and he's going to come see you.
And he was lifting weights.
Yeah.
With your picture up.
Yeah, exactly. So those are three basic questions you need an answer to. Is she still in communication with him if he's incarcerated? Does she visit him? Does he call her on the phone regularly? You need to know, brothers, before you say, I want to marry her. Okay. What is his status with the child? Okay. If he's around, what is the status? A, does he provide child support for the child? B, is there joint custody with the child? Or C, none of the above.
Or Bishop, does he come to the house unannounced?
Right. You want
to
know that?
Because some women have an open door policy with the child's father. He could come whenever he feel like. It could be 3 o'clock in the morning and she won't tell him a damn thing. Yep. And he know he's still running the house. And meanwhile, you come over to visit. You're all dressed up, bought food and everything, and you're here.
Yep.
It's him.
Yep.
Now you got to get out. My baby father's here.
Exactly.
And some of y'all would do it.
Mm-hmm.
How many of y'all would do that thing?
Some of y'all would do it.
None of us going to raise their hand.
That's
but
why
I guarantee you some of them's in
that's
that situation.
That's why I asked the question.
You all online too. You
yes,
too.
Some of y'all would do it. I'm going to be like, I'm answering the damn door. What you want? I've been here. You didn't call. I didn't hear the phone ring. Why are you here?
Mm-hmm.
And then you got to see how she reacts.
Exactly.
You just bought food in a large pizza, plain
exactly.
pizza. Now you open the door.
You who's got this? The special two pies.
What's this? What's this? What's this?
And he came, and now he want a slice.
Exactly.
And the kid will give him the slice.
Exactly.
Now you can't do nothing.
So these are things you got to get. As soon as you meet the sister who has a child, you got to deal with that right. Don't wait for months now after y'all been talking. Deal with that. Right away. Then, what is the mother's state of mind towards you? I'm going to hit y'all with something. Once you will deal with the kid situation, because if the daddy's paying child support and you want to marry her, should he continue paying child support? No, because you're giving him a foot in the door still. Cut the child support off, all right? If there's joint custody now, there's you can't go around that. If you decide to get with her, he's still going to get the child. That's when, give me that scripture about they're unclean. The child is unclean in 1 Corinthians 7 or 11. 1 Corinthians 7. The one about then so the children unclean. You men that get with women who have joint custody with a wicked father, wicked baby daddy, this is what the scripture says.
1 Corinthians 7:14. For the unbelieving husband is sanctified by the wife, and the unbelieving wife is sanctified by the husband. Else were your children unclean, but now are they holy.
Right. So in this context of what Paul is stating, the unbelieving spouse is with you. They're with you because they love you, and they're deciding they're going to keep what the scriptures say, but only because you're saying it, not because they believe. So that makes the unbeliever sanctified. Paul then says, else what else?
Else were your children unclean.
If both of you are not in the Bible, your children would be unclean. So, hence, you, brother, you want to marry a sister who has a child or children. The baby daddy is the devil. He has joint custody. You have bought the daughter, for example, this has happened. You have bought skirts, dresses for the baby girl. The father now gets custody for weekends or whatever. He puts the daughter in pants. You don't got to wear no dresses or no skirts. wear pants. Here comes Christmas. I want it for Christmas. The children are unclean. Why are you fighting for that, men? Some of your mothers fight for that. The Bible says those children are unclean. And don't put your name on the birth certificate of no. I tell you, there was a knucklehead brother. He gets with a pregnant sister who already had four kids. He said, "I'm in love with her. I'm in love with her. I'm in love with her. I'm giving all of my names." So, brother, don't do that. You better wait. He put his name. He gave the baby his name. Now, baby's not his. And put all the kids. My wife knows the story. Put all them kids' name in his name. Once that was done, the woman, she waited a little bit. Then she said, "I'm out." And guess what she went? Court. Child support. Six kids. You got to pay child support. 17% in the rears. You know how much money that is? 17% pay each child in the rears. The kids are there. The brother now crying to us. What am I going to do? You stupid as hell. We told you about that.
Now, you know what's so bad about that? I know of a case like that. And the brother went and proved that the child wasn't his, and they still did not release him off that court. They still upheld the child support case.
That's right.
He had proof. He went and proved that the child wasn't his.
And some of y'all said,
"Well, you still going to pay it."
Some of y'all don't understand that there are some women that the child is just a paycheck. Right. They don't care about you. They don't care about the child. They just realized, "I'm going to be on easy street with this sucker right here." Okay? So I'm going to take him to the cleaners. That's why I forgot who it was that said, "Look, I'm going to work at McDonald's. You're going to get 17% of $150 a week."
There you go. That's it right there.
Y'all wonder how a lot of these brothers end up in jail, because these things will mess a brother's mind up and make him damn near go to murder.
Hey, there was a cop before, a couple of months ago, a police officer in uniform, drove up, followed his wife, and caught her in the street and just shot up into the car. And when they asked why did he execute his wife, it was over child support. He said he was working double in all these shifts and everything. An Edomite cop just went to the car, drove behind it, followed the woman after she dropped the kids off at school and killed her. And was waiting right there for to be arrested because he was tired of paying the child support.
Dang, that's heavy. So, sisters also, some sisters, you rush to introduce your baby, your kids to this brother. You got to pause on that. You got to wait. Start thinking. The wise thing to do, see if y'all get along first before you introduce this man to your children. Like, there are cases on that have been in the news where pedophiles have looked for women with kids and convinced the dumb woman that he loved her.
Right. We play some of those videos in here as well.
Mm-hmm.
See what I'm talking about? We be going over these things.
Yep. And he was a child molester. He just wanted her for the kids. You want to wait before you bring a kid into the man's life. Then once you decide, okay, it's time to introduce it to my kids, see how he gets along with your child or children. Some brothers don't play well with children. Do you know that's not going to work? He's not a child. He's not a kid person. Why marry the brother and he don't have the mentality or patience to deal with children? Sisters, don't marry him. He ain't ready yet. Leave him alone. And brothers, you meet a sister. This has happened in Passover. Brother might look like dirt. It's all right, brother. It's all right. It's dirt for everybody. Somebody for somebody. I'll say something. He looked like Scarecrow. He's Scarecrow. And he's seen certain sisters, and they ignore the brother. They don't want him. But the brother now, past week, stand up and says, "I make X amount of dollars. I got this. I got that." Now, all those same sisters is chasing him. Should he marry either one of them? Hell no!
They didn't hear what you just said. So he put on the Scarecrow outfit.
Mm-hmm.
And he came there, and everybody was shunning away from him. Then he said, "You know what? Now I'm going to let these hoes know what it's really about." So then he came live. And all of a sudden, the hoes became virtuous women.
Mm-hmm. And he went from a Scarecrow to Biggie Smalls cute. Y'all know that song? He's Biggie Smalls cute. Look like dirt, but since he got some money, he cute now. Oh, his earlobes look like Denzel earlobes. She gonna find something cute on you. So you don't want a woman like that. You don't want that. Give me Leviticus 18 about all in the family. You know that verse I want? About a man dealing with the mother. This is another situation. All in the family. Isaac, did you find that?
Yes, Leviticus 18 and 7.
Everybody get it. Everybody, I want you to see this while they're looking for that.
The nakedness of thy father or the nakedness of thy mother shalt thou not uncover. She is thy mother. Thou shalt not uncover her nakedness.
No, that's not it, Isaac. I want the one that says the mother and the daughter. Verse 17.
Thou shalt not uncover the nakedness of a woman and her daughter. Neither shalt thou take her son's daughter or her daughter's daughter to uncover her nakedness.
What happens sometimes, brothers, sisters, listen good. They get with you, and you have an adult daughter. And his intention is not only to get with you. Read it again. Read it again.
Thou shalt not uncover the nakedness of a woman and her daughter.
He not only wants you, the mom, he wants your daughter. And that has you see that on the news all the time. You see that on Maury. You see that on, what's the skinny white guy we talked about earlier?
Jerry Springer.
So the Bible says that's a sin. You got to be wary of things like that. Everybody understand that?
So y'all probably surprised that the Bible has these things in it. Y'all understand? But it's letting you know the Lord knows the Negro too.
Mm-hmm. Brothers, I want y'all to be mindful of this. This is what some single mothers do. Listen good to what I'm about to say. You get with her, and when she wants to manipulate you to get you to do what she wants or to cause contention, this is across the board what I'm about to say. She says, you don't love my child the way you love your child. Let's say you have a kid with her. She will pit your feelings against one child versus the other. It happens all across the board. You don't love my child the way you love this child. Okay? Be mindful of that spirit. Now, you may have done all that you can. You love both, all the kids. But in her mind, and it happens every time we sit down with brothers in council, it's the same story. She is universal. She says, I don't love her child the way I love my child. In her mind, it's your child. And did both of them come out her womb? Yes! But in her mind, that's your child. This one is mine. That's a psychotic mind. Be mindful of the women that do that. And they all do it if they got a kid. You don't love mine the way you love yours. You have a right. What are you going to say?
Even if you didn't even have one yourself. They said, well, if you had one, you would love yours more than mine. That's going over the deep end.
Mm-hmm. And that's a true story, though. That is true.
Did y'all understand what I said? You'd be with a woman that has a child already, and you don't have any. And they said, well, if you had one, you would still treat yours better than the one that you're currently taking care of now.
Right.
That's another level.
You got to watch that. Watch that. Give me 1 Timothy 3 and 5.
First Timothy 3 and 5. For if a man know not how to rule his own house, how shall he take care of the church of God?
That's the measuring stick with the Most High. He judges you as a leader based on how you deal with your family, your household. That's how he looks at you. Now give me the same thing in Revelation 14, 4. Revelation 14, 4 says the same thing. Watch.
These are they which were not defiled with woman.
The women there is really talking about philosophy, but it's also going into that weak nature to a woman, like we read in Esdras with Zerubbabel. Go ahead.
For they are virgins.
For they are virgins, meaning uncorrupted with philosophies. Go ahead.
These are they which follow the Lamb whithersoever he goeth.
God is looking for a man that's going to do what he says wherever, whenever. Not that brothers has to go check with his wife first. Let me go ask if I can do this. He's not looking for a man like that. Was that it over? I went down to 5.
These were redeemed from among men,
uh-huh,
being the first fruits unto God and to the Lamb.
Being the first fruits unto God and to the Lamb.
And in their mouth was found no guile, mm-hmm, for they are without fault before the throne of God.
They are without fault. Read the verse before it again.
These are they which were not defiled with woman, for they are virgins. These are they which follow the Lamb whithersoever he goeth.
These are they which follow the Lamb whithersoever he goeth. That's the part I want to dwell with. These are they which follow the Lamb whithersoever he goeth. The Lamb is Christ. Y'all all right? What did Christ say to do if you're in the house with this woman that's worse than death, whose hands are as bands and traps and snares? What did Christ say do? Escape from her. So these are they which will escape from that type of woman. Can you go to the first verse, Revelation 14, verse 1?
And I looked, and lo, a lamb stood on the Mount Zion, and with him 144,000, having his father's name written in their foreheads.
So the reason why I said to go there is because it's giving you the scenario of the men that the Most High is going to look at that's going to say that they're worthy to be in the presence of his son. And that's what we're trying to groom you, brothers, to be worthy to be in the presence of his son. Now drop down to the fourth verse.
These are they which were not defiled with women.
With philosophies. Okay? Because the first man that was defiled by a philosophy was who? So it's going to be the same thing right now. If you're a weak man that cannot control your house and deal with issues when they come, you're not going to be able to stand in the presence of the Most High. That's why I'm saying to you, it behooves you to get out of that house or get away from that woman or to come clean with the brothers. There's plenty of brothers that have come up to us and told us, look, the woman I'm dealing with, she's a demon. I don't know how to deal with her. What should I do? Okay? And trust me, there's no brother that's came to us that we didn't help. Our track record is 100% success rate. We're going to help you out of that situation. And if the sister get right, we can repair the relationship. If the sister don't get right, she's going to have a whole bunch of brothers she got to deal with because we're going to help our men out. The same way we help the sisters out. We don't let no wicked Negro be up in here abusing no woman, and we just sit back and stay quiet. Okay? It works on both sides. If you're in a situation where you're dealing with someone that's, you cannot work with them, okay? They're uncooperative, they're argumentative. 10 times out of 10, what you need is witnesses. That's why Christ explains in Matthew chapter 18, verse 15, go and get a witness to view this person's behavior, to view that they are unreasonable, they're disrespectful, they're loud. But what a lot of you like to do is keep it quiet and keep it going for years. You're crazy. You don't believe in this Bible.
Deacon Asap, me and Deacon Nathan was listening. You was there in the table when we meet a brother. He said he was trying to get rid of their sister. He only been with us for a year. Was it a year, some month? Then he said, yeah, their sister is wicked. That's why he said, oh, me and Nathan look at each other. So Nathan asked him that, do you still, if you still sleep with the sister. But he calling the sister wicked. But every now and then you go to sleep with the sister, exactly. But he's trying to get rid of the sister.
Right. If she wicked, why are you laying with her? Why are you still having sex with her? Because one of the first things to show that you're taking a stand against her wickedness or his wickedness is not laying with each other. Okay? Because you're sending a message of confusion. And some of you are just there for the sexual lust and the financial gain. You'll sell your soul for sexual favors and money. And what you're saying is that you are not worthy to be a leader in the kingdom of the Most High. Or sister, you're not worthy to come into the kingdom because you're ready to sell your soul. That's why it says in 2 Chronicles, why trimmest thou thy ways to seek love? Some of y'all would do that. Some of you will trim your ways to seek the love of someone. It says, therefore thou hast taught the wicked ones your ways. So the Most High cannot use you. And we saying that to you, brothers and sisters, that think you could hide it. That think you could come here week after week after week and shalom, brother, and to sister, shalom. Meanwhile, you got a demon in your house or the brother got a dragon in his house. And y'all coming in here playing pretend. Like the Most High don't see what's going on in your house. You're not getting no kingdom. So you might as well speak up or get out.
Get that scripture that you quoted, Asaph. It's in Jeremiah.
Jeremiah, I'm sorry. Yeah.
Is it?
233. Jeremiah chapter 2.
Jeremiah chapter 2, verse 33. Why trimmest thou thy way to seek love?
Some of you will trim the ways of the Most High, the laws. Everything you've learned here. Like Deacon Yahusab said earlier. Okay, you come here and you're hearing scripture after scripture after scripture, and you'll do what? Read on? Read it again?
Why trimmest thou thy way to seek love?
You will not apply the commandments, and you will stay in that abusive, wicked, going nowhere relationship to seek the love of that person. What type of message do you send to the world? What type of message do you want to send to the Most High that's watching you to see if you're going to stand up for him? Your ways that you're trimming are the ways of the Most High. So you don't believe. And y'all don't understand, Satan knows when you don't believe. Satan will test you with the next person you got next to you to see, does this nigga believe, yes or no? Does this woman believe, yes or no? But Satan knows that you'll do what? Read it again.
Why trimmest thou thy way to seek love?
Read on.
Therefore hast thou also taught the wicked ones thy ways.
Because what you're supposed to show them is, I believe in this Bible. I'm going to stand for this. You're not going to walk all over me. You're not going to talk to me like that. You're not going to treat the kids like that. You're not going to embarrass me in front of the congregation. He or she is going to get right.
You know, it's here about verse 33. Why trimmest thou thy ways to seek love? Therefore hast thou also taught the wicked ones thy ways. When you trim your ways to seek love, you trim God's commandments. You're setting a bad example. Now let's put it in a household. What happens when you stay in an abusive relationship? What example are you setting for the children? Think about it. This is why some people think it's normal to beat each other up, because they grew up and they saw their father fighting like cats and dogs. So now they're looking for a relationship just like that. Yeah. A toxic relationship, but they think that's normal. Yep. No, these people are crazy.
Yep.
They're the wicked ones the scriptures are going into if you use it in that context. Everybody understand what I'm saying?
You saw your father getting punked, so now you a punk. Mm-hmm. You saw your mother getting her ass beat, so now you a punching bag. But this truth is to stop that. If you believe. If you believe, that's why they call this the medicine. You're going to say, you know what? This is wrong. I got to break this vicious cycle. And then you're going to be tested when you come here to see if you believe.
That's why in 1 Corinthians 7:15, we didn't read the last precept of verse 15. Go back there. Watch what it says. It's heavy. You in toxic relationships.
Mm-hmm. 1 Corinthians 7:15. But if the unbelieving depart, let him depart. A brother or a sister is not under bondage in such cases.
Here it comes.
But God hath called us to peace.
Y'all see that? God calls us in the truth in peace. So why are you fighting, cursing, calling the cops on each other? This
every
is crazy.
Single day. And involving everybody in your business. Mm-hmm. Now, read on. Watch this.
For what knowest thou, O wife, whether thou shalt save thy husband?
Some of you think if I allow him to be, he can punch on me and beat on me, he going to miraculously get saved. The Most High going to be like, you know, you took them punches real well, sister. Look at that black eye. I'm going to sprinkle some magical dust on him, and he's going to make it into the kingdom. Read it again.
For what knowest thou, O wife, whether thou shalt save thy
husband?
You
really believe by allowing him to remain the nigga that he is, he going to get into the kingdom? Or the Most High is just going to just give him a pass, and he didn't make no changes in his life? Read on.
Or how knowest thou, O man, whether thou shalt save thy
wife? Some of you think that you can save your wife in her wickedness. And what he's saying is you don't have no power if they don't repent, if they don't believe. That's why he said, if the unbelieving depart, let them go. A brother or sister is not under bondage in such cases. And Bishop, you don't know how much calls we get of dumb people saying, the church they was with before said, God don't like separation. God want us to stay together. So that's why I stayed and get my ass kicked. Then when I ask them to give me the scripture, they take me right here.
You know,
because the church explained it to them totally wrong.
You know, they taught them, because I heard that doctrine. They said that where it says, please the dwell, meaning that long as you stay in the house together.
Right.
You got a damn gone tornado of dragon crossbreeded with a rattlesnake and a devil. And you're trying to tame that. Talking about something, we please to dwell together. No, nigga, you going to die.
That's Texas Pete. I think that hot sauce
Texas
bottle.
Texas Pete, broken bottles all over the house. You're talking about something, we please to dwell.
Texas Pete, the bottle cut him to the white meat. And put hot sauce in it.
And the scripture, and in Matthew 19, when it says God hates divorce, that's between two believers. That's, get that in Matthew 19. Just, we'll close it out. I'm going to be all long-winded. What verse was that? what God has joined together. Where's that verse there?
19 and 5?
19 and 5.
Yeah, read that.
And said, for this cause shall a man leave father and mother, and shall cleave to his wife, and they twain shall be one flesh.
Read on.
Wherefore they are no more twain, but one flesh. What therefore God hath joined together, let no man put asunder.
Let not man put asunder. It's talking about divorce. No divorce. And Christ is addressing not an unbeliever and a believer. He's addressing, remember, he's talking to Israelites that know what? The law. So he's talking about two believers. He's not talking about somebody worshiping the Greek goddess Diana and an Israelite that's keeping. He's not addressing that. Paul addressed it in 1 Corinthians 7. You have to know the difference, what they're addressing. Everybody understand that?
Shalom, Israel. I'm Elder Nathaniel, Israel United in Christ. YouTube likes to shut our channels down, as some of you have noticed, ever so often. Subscribing to Join IUIC will assure you will always stay connected to our YouTube accounts. We want to do our best to make sure this truth gets out. Please click and join our subscriber YouTube channel called Join IUIC to stay linked to all of our videos. So again, please make sure you subscribe to this Join IUIC channel to get your latest updates on all our YouTube channels. Shalom.